I wish to call the Claremont City Council public meeting on to order at 6:30. I want to welcome everybody that's here tonight. Thank you for coming. The Pledge of Allegiance is going to be done by, I wrote that down, Kenneth Tyree, right? Did I get it right? Get right up.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Let's give him a nice hand for it.
Hope you come back sometime and do it again.
Can we have a roll call, please?
Carolyn Toll.
Here.
Scott Pope.
Here.
Keith Raymond.
Here.
Victor Bergeron.
Here.
Alan Dameron.
Here.
Bruce Temple.
Here.
Nicholas Kloski.
Here.
John Simons.
Here.
Mayor Charlene Lovett.
Right now, we have no scheduled agenda changes. Does anybody want to change anything or thinking about it? There's none. I'm going to go on to the report to secretary. All right. Pick up the minutes of July 27th meeting.
I'll move to approve.
I'll second.
Motion's been made by Councilor Dameron and second by Councilor Toll to accept the minutes of the July 27th meetings. Any changes? Being none, I'll take a vote. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
We're going to move on to the August 3rd meeting.
I make a motion we accept the minutes for August 3rd as written.
Council Toll made the motion to accept the August 3rd minutes as written. Any second?
Second.
Any discussion?
Who made the second?
Council Scott.
Thank you.
Council Scott.
Council Pope, excuse me. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
The August 9th meeting.
Make a motion to approve as presented.
Motion been made by Council Kloski and second by?
I'll second it.
By Councilor Toll. Any discussion on that? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
The August 24th meeting.
Move to approve.
Huh?
Move to approve.
Okay. I'll second.
The motion's been made by Councilor Dameron and seconded by Councilor Toll that the minutes of the 24th meeting be approved. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
September 9th.
Move to approve.
Motion has been made by Councilor Pope to approve the minutes of September 9th as written. Do I have a second?
Second.
Second by Councilor Raymond.
I'm going to abstain. I was not present for that meeting.
Okay. Any other questions or concerns? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 September 14th meeting. We have a motion to accept them as read.
Make a motion we accept the minutes on the 14th as written.
Do I have a second?
Second.
The motion was made by Councilor Toll, second by Councilor Dearman to accept the minutes of September 14th. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
September 26th.
Move to approve.
Motion been made by Councilor Dameron and second by?
I'll second it. Carolyn Toll.
Councilor Toll. Any discussion on them?
On this particular one, Mr. Assistant Mayor, I'm listed here as late, but I'm also listed as arriving twice. On the first page, at the top of the minutes, we show that they were at 6 o'clock. It's listed as 6 o'clock, but then at 5:02, I arrived and I'm late. So, it says the meeting was called to order by Mayor Lovett at 6. Was it 6 or was it 5?
Which? Was this the...
This is the one at the top of Wickham Lane.
It was five, wasn't it?
I think that was five.
It was five.
Yeah.
So we would ask that we change the time on that, and then as we work our way down the page, it says at 5:04, I arrived, and then a little further down the page, it says at 5:11, I arrived again, so I would ask that we remove the 5:11 arrival.
Oh my goodness, you got a twin.
Okay.
Everybody okay with the changes?
Yes.
All those in favor?
Aye.
And now we come to the September 28th meeting.
Move to approve.
Motion's been made to approve by Counselor Demerin.
Second.
Second by Counselor Simons. Any changes or omissions? All those in favor of approving the September 28th meeting?
Aye.
Now we go on to Mayor's notes. Give me a minute here so I can open them up. First one is, part of our fall community cleanup efforts, the city has scheduled several events to help residents in their efforts to beautify their property in the city. And from Monday, October 31st, 2016, through Friday, November 4th, the city will be collecting bagged leaves and grass rakings. Leaves and grass rakings must be placed in compostable bags and left at the curb side by 7 a.m. beginning October 31st. After November 4th, Claremont residents may bring leaves bagged in compostable bags, biodegradable bags, to the transfer station on Tuesdays and Saturdays at no cost. On November 5th, the transfer station will be hosting Tire Day. Claremont residents who have a transfer station decal may dispose of unwanted tires at no charge. The tires are improperly stored, present both an environmental and a health hazard. Your help in the proper disposal of unwanted tires not only improves the environment, but also reduces the possibility of disease spread by mosquitoes. These events are posted on the DPW webpage for your reference. Any other notes? You want to talk about Saturday's event?
I have a couple things that I would like to say. I wasn't ready for this portion of it, but I want to say a couple very positive things that I've seen in the past couple, 2-3 weeks, and one of them is the Fall Festival. It was very well attended, and it was very well run through the Parks and Rec Department and the Chamber of our city, and I just thought that they did an outstanding job, and it was a great day. I also attended a meeting last Thursday night in conjunction with our Children of Claremont, and it was open for all to attend to really procure the development of our children and how they can stay and play and live in Claremont. Very rewarding meeting. Many walks of life came, and I'm waiting for the follow-up from our work that night. Very well attended. And a very positive thing tonight, I was down watching a field hockey game at Monadnock, and there were many soccer players going, there was many football players going, there was varsity football players going. It was just amazing, you know, to see all the positivity in our city at Monadnock Park. And I'll leave you with that.
I just have one more. Over the last 2 days, I've had a chance to see both sides of our economic development in the city. Yesterday, the mayor and I and city manager had an opportunity and some of the staff from planning and zoning to go out to New Hampshire Industries open house. And they have done a fantastic job utilizing that structure and preparing for their operation. It's amazing to hear that they have employees that have been there for 45 and 44 years. You don't hear much of that anymore. It's a company that plans on growing, and so what a great asset to the community. And the other thing, I went down and toured the ink factory's new building. The other part of this economic development, here you have a couple that's lived here in Claremont, had a business, and decided to buy a building that was pretty much ready to fall down. And because of the council working with city manager, adopted the tax incentive program, and they purchased this building and have done a marvelous job with it. They're not quite finished, but it's great to see them staying in their own community and building their building larger. So things are helping a little bit. Anything else?
Well, Stevens High School athletic teams are doing great, as we all know. It's a great time to be Stevens Cardinal fan. One season ended, the Stevens High School golf team finished fifth in the recent state tournament and also had an individual place in the individuals tournament. So
that's wonderful.
Good. Highest they've done.
Anything else?
May I? I forgot to include the fact that I've got, we have tire tracks, which is happening Saturday with three different bike tours. It will start at 10 o'clock down at the junction. And we have a very easy bike tour for families that want to venture out with specific spots to stop and rest and talk. And if you don't want to do it, maybe just come down and see what we're all about. We'll be down at the junction and at 10 a.m. and come in over and talk to us, or you can purchase a ticket. There's a ticket for a bike that we're giving away, the value of up to $400. And we also have tickets for sale for a round trip ticket for New York City by Amtrak. And you can pick your dates. They're not all blacked out for you. So come down and see us on Saturday.
Anything else? I purposely skipped over the proclamation, hoping that she might come in. But since she's not here, I'm going to read the proclamation for Dr. Smith, the president of the college who left. Mm-hmm. A representative from the college will take it after we read it. We'll present it to him. Proclamation, Alyssa P. Harvey Smith, Ph.D. Whereas Dr. Alyssa Harvey Smith served as president of River Valley Community College from March of 2013 through September 2016. And whereas RVCC, Dr. Harvey Smith expanded workforce training and partnership with business and industry. Whereas Dr. Harvey Smith led significant and historic fundraising initiatives, raising more than $1 million in gifts and contributions. And whereas Dr. Harvey Smith opened a co-location in partnership with Granite State College in downtown Claremont. And whereas Dr. Harvey Smith led the development and opening of a new academic center in Lebanon, New Hampshire, to further expand educational access and college service area. And whereas Dr. Harvey Smith revitalized the nursing program and regained national accreditation. And whereas President Dr. Harvey Smith set RVCC on a trajectory for heightened future success and positioned the college to continue to offer life-changing opportunities to students in New Hampshire and to support economic growth within the region. And whereas Dr. Harvey Smith's vision of stabilizing enrollment and growing the college in its present and quality was realized through commitment and devoted leadership and active engagements with both the internal and external communities. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the City of Claremont congratulates Alice B. Harvey Smith, Ph.D., on her successes and wishes the best of luck in her future endeavors. In witness hereof, I have hereon do my hand and cause the seal of the City of Claremont, New Hampshire, to be affixed on this 12th day of October in the year 2016. Charlene Levitt, the Mayor of the City. Would you come up there?
Wait a minute. Good, I'll stick with you.
You're going to speak after.
Yeah. Sure, congratulations on that. You know, I've been on the advisory board at the college for about 9 years now, and I've seen a lot of changes there. None have really happened the last nearly 4 years that Dr. Smith's been here. She reversed that school, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. She has great critical thinking skills. In addition to being an educator, she's a manager. She knows how to get things done, and I've witnessed that firsthand. I've been very, very impressed with what she's done. That proclamation only incorporates some of the things that we could say about her, but we think it's comprehensive, and she's done so many things at the school to turn it around, including getting the reaccreditation of the nursing program, which we had lost, and bringing Lebanon online up in the north and making that a branch of the River Valley Community College. And she's hired some good people that we know will do the job going forward. She's entering, by the way, a system of 95,000 students in Texas. She'll be second person there, and I can't wait to see her success, and I will follow it closely, and we're sure she'll get that done. So congratulations to her and to the school and to the people who've taken over. We have a lot of confidence there. We have a lot at stake at the school because we're looking for a job training program that we need, and some of the kids who find they want to go back to school, especially at River Valley, are showing up there, and we're just delighted with it. So thank you very much, and I'll be speaking to her the next couple of days. I know she was too busy today to get here, but I will talk to her about the proclamation and what we think of her. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye. Mr. Sandgate, you want to give your city manager's report?
Yeah, sure. You mentioned that we're down to the New Hampshire Industries, and really an upbeat event. The building, if you say it's 3 football fields long, it may be an understatement. It's a huge special purpose property and not easy to fill. The water bottling plant built that plant years ago. When the recession hit, people stopped buying a lot of bottled water and started using tap water. And they opened a plant in Massachusetts at the same time, so they never really moved in, and we felt that may be vacant for a long, long time because it does take a special company to take that kind of space. And we were very fortunate for the work of Nancy Merrill and people at the planning office and focusing on getting that done. We're very fortunate to bring that kind of company. It's a manufacturing company with good-paying jobs that will have the kind of spin-off effect that we look for here, because it will generate not only jobs but disposable income that give a good living wage that people can spend in the local community, and that's what communities are about. So we're delighted to have that done. It's the second special purpose property that we're able to fill in the last year and a half or so. The other one was Lowe's. When Lowe's moved out, that's a very difficult building to occupy because of its size, and running stores are down and out. So we've been very successful at getting those kind of things done, and we welcome New Hampshire Industries to the city, and anything we can do in the future to help them moving forward, we want to be able to do. You mentioned, Mayor, that there'd be a leaf pickup and a tire disposal issue. The leaf pickup we do annually, but it's important that people understand that they must have their bags out by 7 a.m. on Monday, October 31st. Now, we'll be picking up for the next week, but we may not go back to streets that we cover initially. So we may miss you if you don't get the bags out there before 7 a.m. on Monday, October 31st, even though they'll be out there for a week as we pick them up. It's also important that they use paper bags. We will not take plastic bags. We can't dispose of those. And if anybody fills them with plastic bags, we will leave them there because we can't take them and can't pick them up. And that's very important to do. You also mentioned the tire program. We did that earlier in the year, and we collected so many disposed tires that helped clean up the city. We're running another one this coming month, and people can participate in that or not. If they don't have time to do that, they can bring the tires up to the transfer station any Tuesday or Saturday at no cost. The tire can be as large as 20 inches and smaller. That would include motor vehicles and small trucks may fit that category. You have to check with the size of the tire, but we'll be running those kind of programs in the next month. So the other thing I want to talk about is we're beginning union negotiations. We started with the fire department some months ago. Their contract ends a year earlier than clerical, police, and DPW. So we're starting the other three unions this coming week. We have preliminary meetings set up to discuss some of the items. We just want you to know the attempt will be to renegotiate present union contracts, and we'll keep the council informed as we move forward and bring any items out here that need to be brought out. I mentioned this to the last meeting, I want to make a reminder that the Conference of New Hampshire Conservation District will be held Thursday and Friday, October 13th and 14th, that's this week, at the Common Man. And I might read a small paragraph to describe in that event. The New Hampshire Conservation Commission will be conducting a two-day seminar slash meeting at the Common Man Restaurant in Claremont on October 13th and 14th. One of the reasons they have chosen Claremont is the great work our staff did in remediating the badly contaminated site along the Sugar River. This $4 million cleanup was no small achievement, is recognized by environmentalists from across the state as a major success and a model for others to follow. I would encourage council members to attend this very important event, which will bring much deserved credit to the city of Claremont. The fee to attend the event is $50 for one day or $75 for both days. The mayor and I will both participate in the event at the Common Man. And Jane Taylor and Kurt Beek from the planning office, both of those people were instrumental in getting this done. They're the people who really did the grunt work to get it done. They'll be presenting to people all around the state on how we accomplish that event. So that's a very important event to go to. On the forestry management plan, everyone knows we met up at Bridge Ave and we discussed that, and then we wanted to give an update that the directors and representatives from the Conservation Commission having a meeting about the Winter Street bid next Thursday, right? Yeah. And we need to make sure we are following the management plan and ask the low bidder to recalculate his bid to just thinning a third of the freeze up. This, we're cutting back on what we're doing there. But we want people to understand that we said we'd hold up the forestry program and recommit it to the Conservation Commission, but we also said this program at Winter Street already begun, and I'd update you at the meeting, and the update is that we're going ahead with that cut. And but we'll be back here before we do anything up at the Fringe Avenue. And it will allow the Conservation Commission to revisit that purpose there. I have maybe a couple of other small notes, but one of them that I want to mention that is not so small, because Mayor Bergeron brought this up, I think a month ago, when I called the superintendent of schools to follow up. You pointed out that on election day, November 8th, right, is election day, that there was plans to use the school outside of the election taking place. Well, I got a memo from Milton McGoodwin, superintendent of schools, and he said with a record turnout expected at the polls on November 8th, the school board recently approved the following changes, and this was at your request, Mayor. Monday, November 7th, no school. The 7.5-hour parent-teacher conference planned for November 8th will be held on November 7th at the school. Tuesday, November 8th, at election day, no school, no parent-teachers. So the schools will not be used other than the election. And that's important to presidential election, because we know how busy that gets. And we want to encourage people to get there, not be discouraged that they can't park or other events are taking place at the school. So we thank the school board and the superintendent for cooperating with the administration here. And I think it served the people of the city well to get that done. And I think I'll leave it there, Mayor. I won't take any more of your time.
Okay. I can find my reports. Yes.
I have a couple of questions for the city manager first. One of them is the last council meeting, there was a great desire to make the crosswalks safer, and I don't know where that's at. I saw a situation back down on Main Street by Leo's again, where somebody almost got hit. So I wanted to bring that up.
I can maybe respond to that if you'd like.
Okay.
We were planning to put that on the traffic committee's agenda. The traffic committee includes the chief of police, chief of fire, and DPW director, and I sit in those meetings, and that way, all departments that appropriate are present to discuss that and discuss the merits of it, number one. Two, if something should be done, and if something should be done, what should be done? So that will be taken up.
When is that meeting?
So, wait, do we have that scheduled yet?
No.
Not yet. Not scheduled. When it is, we can notify the council of that.
You have it, it'll be in October?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Thank you. The other thing is, we used to have bike racks in front of the city hall, and I was wondering, where have they gone? Particular because of the bike tour this weekend, where part of our tour is coming into the city of Claremont, to downtown center.
Well, I don't know, except there were a lot of changes made out front, because we got rid of some signs and some areas that were cluttering up the front. But the bike racks, I don't recall those being removed by...
They're removed.
Well, we can find out why.
Okay. Yeah. Well, if we could find where they are, maybe we can get them up for this weekend. I've been trying to figure out where they are. I haven't gotten the answer yet.
No.
So. And then I have some department questions, but somebody else can take the floor if they have other questions of the department.
Well, I have a question for Mrs. Sandegate on the New Hampshire Conservation Commission seminar that's going on the next 2 days. I didn't get the time, day, what's the timeline for those?
I believe it's 9 a.m., but we can send out an email on the time of the event at the Common Man, and we forward that to the council members. We'll get that right out to you tonight, maybe.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
All right.
All set?
Anybody else have any department
anybody
questions?
Anybody else got anything down here?
The first one is for the fire department. I know that you devoted a lot of your information this month to the fact that you're really riding, you know, the homeowners of multiple family housing. We thought it was working when we increased the fines, but when they don't show repetitively, my question is, how can we help you with that? Because I think it's an issue for you. I mean, obviously, you spent almost two paragraphs explaining where this was at. So,
and obviously, I don't have a copy of my report in front of me, but
you want, here, take.
I okay. think I can answer your question regardless. I think I mentioned in my report that it's essentially several problem property owners that we have reoccurring issues with no-shows. And if you also, if you recall, one of the purposes of increasing the amount for the no-show fee was to allow city treasurer to file claims with small claims court to try to recover these funds, and there was a minimum level that she was unable to we were not attaining because the fines were so small. And the answer to your question is, what can you do to help? I'm not sure, because at this point in time, it would require some sort of legal action against the property owners that don't show. The first step of the first legal action that we had envisioned was the small claims court path. I don't know if that's been able to be pursued against any of them. And beyond that, it becomes difficult. And I know at a few times in the past, we've procured administrative search warrants to complete the inspections without the presence of the property owner. But obviously, we don't have anyone in the fire department that's totally capable of doing that. We could probably work our way through it, but that would be probably the next step. There is one other option that we've used in the past, and that is to enlist the assistance of the New Hampshire State Fire Marshal's Office. We've done that in the past with a few of the properties. And the same, the trouble that we've run into there is they are so busy throughout the state that it's a long process, taking sometimes a year to a year and a half for them to actually complete their inspection and follow up and to achieve some sort of corrective action with these properties. So I don't know if that's a summation of what we're faced with.
You're asking for help, and it's quite obvious, you know, with this to us. And I wanted to bring it up so that we all think about it. But I think there has to be a course of action that we're all going to have to work on.
I agree. And as I said in my report, you know, in large part, the property owners work very well with the fire captains, and we come up with corrective action plans, and they follow up with the processes, and they do their, you know, their upgrades within certain time requirements, and eventually the properties receive a compliance letter. And in most cases, that's what happens. So, but there are several owners that are very difficult to deal with.
I don't like that word several. That really bothers me. It's really a need of course.
It bothers us too, because...
Wait a minute, Chief. This isn't the time to discuss that. You're asking this information. This is something that's going to go to a future agenda item.
Absolutely, and that's why I brought it up.
Come and discuss this whole thing.
I have one other question for the Chief. That's all I have. But I noticed on the apparatus breakdown, Engine 1 and Engine 3 are having problems for responses. Is that just, I'm reading this differently? It says apparatus breakdown.
No, that's, breakdown is not being used as mechanical failure. Breakdown is used as which pieces of apparatus are responding to each individual call.
Okay.
So we're breaking down.
I feel much better.
Okay.
Thank
no,
you.
No, it's not mechanical breakdown.
I didn't know how to read it, so, you know.
No, it's a computer printout, I understand.
Thank you, Chief. That's all I have.
And we'll move on to appointment to boards and committees. And the first one I see is the Historic District Commission.
Email. I've got a different email. Back at 3.
Yes.
I'd like to nominate Abigail Carmen to the Historic District Commission.
Which seat?
This would be seat 5.
I will second.
Second by Councilor Dearman.
Busy girl.
Any questions?
I don't think it was seat 5.
I see seat 3.
Seat 3. Last one on the paper.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 All opposed? Okay. Let me just click down a little bit more here. Whoop, that's the only one we have. Then we're going to go to Citizens Forum. Now, before we go to Citizens Forum, I want to explain the rules. It's 5 minutes. John, Councilor Simons, will you hand up since some people haven't seen them?
Sure.
It's what? After 2 minutes, you show the yellow?
No, there's a one-minute warning. You have a minute left.
Yellow and red says it's time for you to stop.
Time's expired.
So I'll open this up to citizens. You can talk about non-agenda items. Does anybody like to come up to the podium and speak on a non-agenda item? Please come up and introduce yourself.
Hi, my name is Dodi Kidder, and I have the memory card car out front for Cody LaFont. And I would like to request that the council submit a letter to the state requesting to expedite the investigation and the release of information to the family.
The
We are going to have to talk to our attorney about that. I don't think we can, but I'll talk with the city manager. Would you talk with the chair?
I'll talk to our city attorney about it.
Okay.
They make that request. You have your name and phone number to Doray over here.
Okay.
Or contact my office tomorrow with it. We'll appreciate that.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Let's wish to speak?
There's no one else. I'd like to address the council, if I may.
Well, I guess we'll let you. Council, I'll stay with that.
Okay. You have 5 minutes.
I'll run this timer.
I don't want to go over. Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and fellow council members. I wanted to take 5 minutes of your time to discuss my campaign for re-election for sheriff. As all of you know, and many people in the public know, I was elected sheriff in 2014. The thing I wanted to make sure I put across to everyone is the sheriff is a leadership position. I'm a 26-year law enforcement veteran, and in that time, almost 10 years of that time has been in a leadership position. Before being elected sheriff, I was chief deputy of the Sullivan County Sheriff's Office, where I worked under the high sheriff to run the day-to-day operations of the sheriff's office. Almost 12 years of my career were here in the city of Claremont. I performed many roles here. I was a patrol officer, a tactical officer, a detective, was the prosecutor, and I was promoted to corporal, where I shared the responsibilities of supervising a patrol shift here in the city. I have a degree in criminal justice. I'm a 2015 graduate of the National Sheriff's Institute, and I'm the only sheriff in the history of Sullivan County to have attended that school. And I can always continue on my education. I also recently attended the FBI Regional Command College. Both of these schools teach leadership and management for law enforcement executives. After I got elected in 2014, Senator Shaheen came to the city to discuss the opioid crisis that was going on in the country. The city manager was there, as well as the police chief and other members of the community. At the end of that conversation, we discussed, you know, what could we do in law enforcement to try to curb the stem of tide of drugs constantly coming into our area. Since then, I've taken an aggressive approach to the opioid crisis in Sullivan County. I spearheaded the formation of a regional drug intelligence network, where investigators from both New Hampshire and Vermont get together regularly and discuss drug intelligence. As I found over the course of other conversations after meeting with the senator, that drugs were coming primarily in our area, much of that was coming up I-91. I learned that the Vermont State Police were really doing a good job in taking drug dealers off of I-91. So what I did was I reached out to all the police departments on both sides of the river in New Hampshire and Vermont, from Langdon to Lebanon and from Bellows Falls to Hartford, and all the departments in Sullivan County. We all got together and we discussed the issue, and thus this group of investigators was formed. Very proud of that. So far in 2016, we've had 6 opioid-related deaths here in the county. Too many people are dying from these overdoses and across the country, and especially in our own area. I've taken the time to bring the opioid antidote Narcan to all my deputies at the sheriff's office, so each deputy that drives a patrol cruiser through the county is equipped and trained to administer Narcan for people who are overdosing on opioids. As you know, I'm currently in my second term as a city councilor. I very much enjoy this position. As a councilor, I'm engaged in reviewing department budgets, listening to citizen concerns, and working to do my best to be a good part of the city. As the sheriff, I presented the last 2 fiscally responsible budgets to the county administration. I'm a member of the executive board of the Attorney General's Drug Task Force, and I'm the current chair of the Sullivan County Chiefs of Police Association, and I work closely with those chiefs. The sheriff, again, is a leadership position. I ask you not to think about political party in this election. Sheriff is only political in that it's an elected position. I serve all the citizens, whether they be Republican or Democrat, and it makes no difference to the sheriff. My philosophy since the very beginning has been it's all about public service. I want you to, as a voter, think about this as a job interview and compare my qualifications with that of my opponent. If you want to know a police officer, ask a police officer. So I want to give you a list of current Sullivan County law enforcement executives who are publicly endorsing me for sheriff. Chief Alex Scott, Claremont. Chief Jim Burrows, Newport. Chief Pat Connors, Charlestown. Chief Ray Labby, Langdon. Chief Paul Roberts of Plainfield. Chief Doug Hackett, Cornish. Chief Richard Lee of Croydon. Chief Walt Medor of Grantham. Chief Ed Anderson of Goshen and New London. Chief Tim Julian of Springfield. And Chief Ryan Murdo of Washington. Additionally, the following law enforcement executives that are retired are also publicly endorsing me. Retired Sheriff Michael Prazo, again, as in 2014, is endorsing me. Retired Chief Alan Susi from Sunapee. Retired Chief David Hoyt of Newport. Retired Chief Gordon Gillen of Plainfield. And retired Chief Steve Marshall of Washington. Retired Deputy Chief Bill Wilmot from Claremont. And retired Executive Major Barry Hunter from the Hampshire State Police. Every member of the Sullivan County Sheriff's Office is endorsing me. I have earned their respect over the course of the time that I've been the sheriff, and all 15 members are endorsing me. I'm asking you to ask these chiefs and any police officer you see on the street, I feel confident that if you speak with any of your local police officers, they're going to tell you who they feel is the best person to lead the sheriff's office out of my opponent and myself. I'm firmly committed to the citizens of Sullivan County. I began my career in 1990 and have continued to serve with honor and integrity for 26 years. In 2014, the voters of Sullivan County made an investment in me when you elected me sheriff, and I'm asking for your vote on November 8th to allow me to continue to pay off on that investment. Thank you. Yep.
Anybody else wish to speak on a non-agenda item? Seeing none, I close citizens forum, and we'll move on to unfinished business, old business, I should say. And the first topic that's coming up is the second reading of the 505 cemetery policy. It is a public hearing, but before I open it up to council discussion, I want to correct a few errors that were posted in the editorial. Number one, I have no decision-making powers whatsoever at St. Mary's to deal with the cemetery. The reason I know the law is my family's been buried there for 100 years, and we get copies of the rules every year. I have no decision-making in that process. It had nothing to do with my decision-making. Second one, we have two citizens on the committee, Alan Spar and Abigail Carmen. And on number one, the thing that there's nothing in the new bylaws or new ordinance has anything to do with picnics. So that's the corrections from the... Number one, you listed picnics. There's nothing to do with picnics in the new ordinance. Well, you must have the wrong one. I don't see picnics in it.
We're going to reread it, aren't we?
No.
No.
Any of the council has got anything to say? I'm going to open to the public, and we'll come back to the council. Okay, this is now open for the public to speak on. Yes?
You want to make a motion and then open it?
Yes. Yeah. Let me make a motion to second the ordinance, please, so we can open to the public.
I'll read the motion. Ordinance 550, cemeteries. Explanation, proposed action. The purpose of this proposal is to revise the municipal cemetery rules and regulations as recommended by the City Council Ad Hoc Policy Committee. Enactment of this ordinance will update and clarify the municipal cemetery rules and regulations.
Do I have a second?
I'll second.
All set? All those in favor?
No.
Don't need to?
Open the public.
Let's go on then. It's open to the public. Listen to people have to say. Each speaker has same rules, 5 minutes and time. Please introduce yourself, what ward you're in.
Hi, my name is Tina Rock and I'm in Ward 2. And I believe Section 1677 purpose, no, 1678, conduct in cemeteries. Number four, use the cemeteries as picnic grounds or consume alcohol beverages in a cemetery or bring the same upon the premises. Now, I forgot my papers. I believe back in February, I asked the council, I came and I wrote a letter to Mr. Sandigate. I asked, which, of course, Assistant Mayor Bergeron, you were there, along with Mayor. I asked for some of the rules to be changed because I thought, seeing they were done back in 1978, we needed updates. There's a new era, more people have heart, love, believe, and they believe in things now. Back in that meeting, you told me that was not going to happen. When the cemetery was put together, I believe Scott Pope, yourself, Mr. Dameron, and Mr. Simmons were in there with two other people that wrote letters saying about my structure. When I went to those meetings, basically I kept quiet because I didn't want to say anything to upset your rulings because it was kind of your meeting to put the rules together. But if you recall, in that table, none of you even moved a chair to say, hey, join in with the rest of us. So for one, that was really bad. For two, when I went the second time, all you said is change this to DPW, change that to DPW. I was there 15, 20 minutes. The meeting was over after that because you said, well, Tina, I guess we're done. Thank you for coming. The only thing I said about is the dog waste, which is already posted, which nothing has ever been done about, not even by our public workers. A lot of the things is in the paper, how I feel, and there's a lot of people that feel the same way. I'm sorry to say, but in St. Mary's, where your family is buried, I believe Manchester are the ones that basically rule that you do not have the Claremont raking and cleaning up for you. You have your private citizen doing it for you, that St. Mary's themselves, excuse me, yes. Unless you're in the new section, you have somebody else doing the raking. I talked to them today, and he told me that he does it with one lawnmower, 46 inches. He has a hard time with the throttle. It's him himself, 35 hours a week, doing 10 acres over there. And he said, people that work there should have a little bit of heart. He sees people every day going in and out of that cemetery, and they're doing it with love for their emotions. He said, none of this stuff bothers me. So for you guys to put a time limit on what time we can go in and out when it gets dark at 4 o'clock, I think is sad. People just go in their car, do a quick ride-by, check on things, say hello, and leave. If people want to have a sandwich, like Mayor Levitt said, I think they should be able to sit there and have a sandwich with their loved ones and not have to call the people that are so busy, DPW, and ask permission to sit there and have a sandwich. And I really don't think it's any concern as long as it's clean and it's neat. I have taken care of my own. The fertilizer, the grass, I've asked the city to put hay down. They didn't have time. I did my own because they didn't have time. I saved you guys money is the way I look at it. I brought in bags from the store. I unloaded them. I raked them. I seeded it. We went and got the hay. Me and my family have taken care of everything. So, you know, when it comes to these rulings on half of them, I just don't understand where the heart is. I just don't understand. And I have a hard time with it because some of these rules are just crazy. And I think you guys need to stop and think about that. And that's it.
Can I ask you a question? What copy of the ordinance do you have?
She doesn't have
the new one.
Can't have, because there's nothing in conduct of the cemetery. It says anything about picnics.
It's in the old. That's in the old.
That's the old one.
It already exists.
It already exists.
That's the one that exists.
Those have been existent since, what? I'm looking at the date.
No, they've got both of them for people to read, the new one and the old one.
Yeah, I believe the new ones are the same thing, except for Mayor Lovett said, well, I go there myself and have picnics on Memorial Day weekend.
Mr. Mayor? Excuse me, can you give me that section that you were reading when you first started? You said 1678?
Yes.
Yeah. My 1678, I can read it.
It's different.
It's all, you know, the new one is different than what the old one is and doesn't say anything
about it. Well, honestly, I don't think this one is right anyway. And then the other question I have, too, is you guys say no walls, fencing, this and that. What about all those people who have already had the bricks around their stone for so long? What are we going to do? Make them pick it up? I mean, what about all the shrubs that have been planted in the last 20 years? My father's been there 22 years. I know there's been shrubs and trees and everything already planted. Mm-hmm. And I've said to you guys, and I have it in a letter as well, the school needs community hours. Why can't they go and pick up sticks and help do something if the city has such a hard time doing it? Why can't we use some of that? Or why can't people like me go in where I want it to be beautiful? Why can't I go in and help make it beautiful? I'm sorry, but you know, it's not just the roundabout of Broad Street. It's not just Tremont Square. There's other places that need to be kept up too. And it's not just, it's for people that care.
Councilor Polk, can I ask you a favor? Can you get her a copy of the new one? that's there.
Right. And in the old structure, it also said you could have shrines, monuments, and structures. So I did not go against that law. And you know what? Right now, my structure is not important. I thank you all, the 90 signatures, and all of the people who backed me up on that. But right now, I think there's other more important things that you guys need to think about other than my shrine. I think you need to think about letting people in when they need to let them mourn. We all have different ways of doing that.
There's none there.
Hold on.
I had copies out.
You did?
They've all been...
They're all gone?
Look for mine so I can give her...
Anybody else wish to speak? Come forward.
Deborah Chase, Ward 2. I don't feel good today. Sorry I'm bringing a cold in here, but I felt that this is very important. I, too, have family that's been in that cemetery. I buried my mother there in 1986. And when I saw a letter that was written to the city council and then you guys are entertaining it, I thought it was a little bit ridiculous. I, too, feel that the cemetery is for personal reasons and people buy their plots to bury their loved ones. And if I want to put, if my grandson wants to put a toy truck on my mother's stone, he should be able to do it. It's a little toy truck. It's a plot. As long, I don't have a problem with this, with the cemetery, as long as it's kept clean and neat and safe. This shouldn't be, this shouldn't even be in a meeting. It's ridiculous. It's a waste of everybody's time. So I wrote this up, and I just wanted to add this. I have family and friends buried in Mount View Cemetery. I've been visiting the cemetery since 1996. When my mom passed away at age 46, I found myself bringing her little things to put on her stone just because it made me feel better. My children were 2 and 4 at the time. My 4-year-old would have her stuffed animal, leave her a necklace, a rose. Sometimes she would leave a book on my mother's stone because she didn't understand the concept that Grammy was in heaven, and she thought maybe she'd come read the book anyway. So we left the book there. But we always go there every day and check on it. It's not like we're littering or anything, you know, we made it safe and sound. I have always thought that the cemetery was neat and clean, and I never had a problem with it. I've never complained about it. Everybody's pretty good about everything there. I've never had any issues. Upon finding out that a couple of people are complaining about certain temporary structures, certain items, and certain items in the cemetery that were referred to as toys, etc., and a nasty, rude, inconsiderate letter of complaint that was written to the city, I don't see where this should be entertained. If something is put in the cemetery and it's safe and sound and structurally everything's okay with it, people shouldn't be complaining. The cemetery is a place for mourning, and we do not tell each other how to mourn because nobody mourns the same way. I'd like for you to remember when changing the rules what the cemetery is really for. The Rocks have obtained over 90 signatures that state that they have no problem with the structure. It's neat and clean, and they check on it every single day. And I go to the cemetery every single day, too. And I go through the whole cemetery. I walk around. If I see trash, I pick it up. I am a concerned citizen for the cemetery. I really don't see any reason for complaining about this structures or certain personal items on somebody's stone, as long as it's not interfering with somebody else's plot. I think the rule should state that temporary structures shall be permitted, providing that they are structurally safe and cannot be put up until the first day of winter and must be removed by the first day of spring and not interfering with anybody else's plot. And that's my opinion on this whole matter. I just can't even believe that this has come this far. We believe in the mortality and soul and decorate graves accordingly for everybody's different religion. Like I said, I don't see why we're entertaining this. There hasn't been any issues or any police calls or anything bad down to the cemetery. I think this whole thing needs to be thought of before everybody starts jumping to writing rules. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm going to take down my copy today.
Okay, go ahead. Anybody else?
Yes, my name is Sharon Boudreau. I agree with everything the girls say. I can't see why the DPW would be making...
What's your word, please?
Two.
Thank you.
I don't understand why they're making more rules when they can't even keep up with what they got. So what is the sense in taxpayers paying for something else as we pay for guys to walk around and sit around as it is? I'm down there every day, and I take the whole day just about sometimes so I can ride around and see what they're doing and what they're not doing. There's hardly no grass left at Mountain View. It's all weeds now. When Mr. Goey was there and I worked there, there was grass. And when we mowed and when we weed whacked, we also took a brush in our pocket and we brushed off the stones. And we got the cemeteries done in no time. So anyway, my husband's there for 22 years. My daughter's there for 48. I've always had a rubbish barrel just up the walk, which would be actually across from my grandson's. But they conveniently took that away now. My niece, they took it away from where she can walk. But you go to St. Mary's, yes, and there's plenty of rubbish cans up there. We take our rubbish back home with us, though. I like to put down a wreath at Christmas time for my daughter and my husband, and I do my grandson, and I go get it as soon as the time is over. And yes, I do like to go down there when it's dark so I can sit in peace and quiet without the work of staring and watching every move you make, so they can go talk about it at some other place here in town. Anyway, I think they've taken on more than they can chew. And my daughter does have grass down there at my grandson and at my husband's, and she does mow it, because otherwise it don't get mowed. A 52-inch lawnmower is a bird brain decision by the city of Claremont. That is too big to fit through most of the grave sites. And when I worked there, there was 42 or 46. And we weed whacked. And we brushed. And there's none of that now. Thank you.
Anybody else wish? Yes, over here. Please introduce yourself. What ward you're from, please?
I'm Wandsleben, Ward 1. I'd like to thank the committee and the council for the work they've done on this ordinance. I think we all realize that we need to have regulations and laws within the city. I'm not opposed to people grieving in their own way, but I am opposed to the fact that there are a lot other families there, more than the 90 who signed the petition, and I think it's offensive to other families who have loved ones that are buried in that cemetery to go by and see structures and to see things that are similar to a yard sale. I don't want to see that when I go there.
Hold it, ladies and gentlemen. Nobody interrupted when you talked. Please don't interrupt people who are talking against you or their opinion. Let's be fair on this.
I think that there needs to be rules. I think that having structures will where does that end, you know, once you have it? Anyway, I frankly agree with the council. I think that has been a good decision, and I think it's fair.
Anyone else wish to talk? Go ahead.
My name is Sabrina Spiller, and I think I'm Ward 2. I just moved back to the area from New London, so I'm not sure. I live on Old Newport Road. Anyone know for sure?
That's Ward 3.
Ward 3. Okay, so I'm Ward 3. Yeah. The only thing I would like to ask is the reconsideration on the one monument to cemetery plots. I recently lost my husband, and I have a family plot of 8, and my great-grandfather is actually the one who purchased the 8 plots. So there's a headstone up there for them. But I don't have a headstone to go and mourn my husband to at all. So, but because of the ruling of the one monument, I can only have that one headstone there. So I'd like to see, like, maybe some consideration to...
Director Scott, can I ask you?
I'm not sure. I might be reading the wrong thing here, too.
Can I wait until you answer all the questions at the end of everybody's speech? You may have more of them.
Sorry, I'm just reading this, so I don't know that I'm actually.
I think it says says on a. I'll let the director answer that.
That's something I would like maybe to have a little more thought to and consideration for. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good.
Bill Matthews, Ward 2. I agree that in a civilized society, there has to be rules and regulations. You can't just do what you want to do and get away with it. And I'm sure that the police chief will agree with me. I can explain a couple of things down there. For one thing, you can't use a 52-inch mower if you got trash all over the place. And I say trash because some of these places look like a yard sale about to happen. That along with structures that have no bearing at all with the cemetery. And I appreciate what the commission has done for us. That's it. Thank you.
You'll be next. She had her hand up.
Jill Davidson, Ward 1. I just want to say I appreciate all the work that has gone into this whole process of kind of coming up with these things. It's not easy to please everyone, but I think that the committee did a lot of good work in trying to take everything into account to make it the best for the city and for the cemetery and all those that use it.
All set, ma'am?
My name's Christine Hooper, Ward 3. I don't feel it's right to try to micromanage what's considered acceptable for our own plots, for our loved ones. You know, I think it's inappropriate to try to control something so personal. I mean, myself, I like going down there and putting memorabilia down to my loved ones' plots, and we make sure we pick it up. You know, that helps me with our grieving process. It shouldn't be about being visual pleasing for others, you know? It's about me, it's about my loved one. That's what I think, and that's what I think about the structure. If she needed this structure, you know, it helped her get through these times. And it's during the winter months. It's not really, I don't see, a lot of people don't even go in there because you do have it closed. She walks in. But, you know, it's not even about that anymore. But as far as putting flowers down, memorabilia, Christmas, that's the way I share my holiday with my loved one, is putting those little things down. That's it.
Thank you. Anyone else wish to speak? Being none, I'm going to bring it back to the council. Can I have Director Sweet answer some of the questions before we begin? Is that possible, ladies and gentlemen? Can you come up and answer some of the things that were
concerns? Good evening. First one is the headstone. If you have 8 lots, you can fit as many, if they're in straight line, you can fit as many stones on that, on your lot. It's not just one stone. It's, you can fit, if you got 8 stones, that's 21 feet roughly, or 25 feet. So you can fit stones in a line there if you want.
You have to come up to the microphone, please, if you want to talk. Nobody can hear you on television.
My question is, what about in the Union Cemetery where some people can't have stones and then it's not all in a straight line?
That's a different committee that runs that. City of Claremont doesn't run it. West Claremont Burial Ground has a committee.
I was told it was, I believe you were there at the table. You said all cemeteries have the same rules.
No.
West Claremont Burial Ground does not.
Okay.
They have their own, we do all their maintenance and mowing and all that, but then they have their own layout of their stones. They made their own map for that.
Okay. So because I got distracted with him saying about the thing, curbs and fencing, no, and this is the new one, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So that means that anybody who has anything down right now mm-hmm. is okay. Because in when we were doing the thing...
Right, I don't see how we can go and take that away from them right now.
Okay. So you're saying my stuff that I have down is good. You're not going to go in because it says if it's not, that you guys have the right without notice just to go in and pick it up.
Well, by November 1st, we have to go in and take the plantings, whatever plantings you have.
Right. But anything... that is locked down. So, and that's the other thing. I just don't understand. All you guys do is plow in there. But so, my little monument structure that's by my headstone is cemented in there. Are you going to rip that out of the ground? Is my question.
Is it within 18 inches?
I don't know. But again, you know, not everybody knows. Hold it.
Please. Just so everybody knows. This ordinance shall take effect and be enforced immediately upon passage. There's no grandfather clause in this ordinance. Okay. So he can, if he so chooses, he can pull it out under this ordinance if it's passed.
It's been here, though.
He's just saying you won't.
If it's been here, you just said, right? If it's been here, you're not ripping up the walls and the fences that are already there.
I think anything new, we have to keep track of anything new.
Right. Mine's been there for 2 years. That's not good.
Can you...
And I've owned the lot for 22 years.
Right. We have to pick up your flowers and stuff, whatever. Unless you pick them up by November 1st, we have to go around and pick those up.
Right.
And we don't mind people bringing in wreaths for
yes.
Christmas time or
Hold
a balloon.
I appreciate, but since the public part of this has been closed, I have questions, but I have to tell you honestly, I'm not comfortable proceeding with this tonight because we don't even have the city attorney here. So a lot of these questions that are being bounced back and forth, I've been in this seat before where we will find out later that something we did is not legal.
She wrote this.
I understand that, but these questions that are being asked and he's being put right on the spotlight to answer questions that... I want the correct answer.
We also don't have enough copies of the policy.
I also don't have a printed copy, and I'm having a hard time with this whole laptop system where I'm scrolling to the old one and the new one, and that's a different topic. But I personally am not comfortable proceeding with this tonight.
So we'll recognize
Claremont
is
out of order.
You haven't been recognized. Please go.
I was just going to say maybe we can pass these out.
What?
Wait, especially when you sell a lot.
We don't have the new one. Yes.
Have a meeting, no papers.
Makes sense. Let's bring this, stay right there. Let's bring it back to the council for discussion.
Yeah, I think I'd make a motion to table this ordinance from this evening till our next council meeting, where we can have enough copies here for people, and the city attorney can be present to answer any questions that may arise.
You said next council meeting. Do you mean the October 26th or do you mean November 9th?
October 26th.
Thank you.
I think we've spent, and the committee has spent quite a bit of time, and we spent
sure
quite
have.
A bit of time during the first iteration going through this in public session. I think it deserves to be completed. And I think the committee's done good work, but there are questions that people have that need an answer. So I'd make that motion to table this evening.
Fine. It's council's decision.
I'll second it for discussion.
Okay, I have no problem with it.
No.
But I think the director has the right to answer some of the questions that were put forth to him.
I do as well.
Certainly.
And I want to shine up some information from previous council discussions on this as well, which... People want to change it, they change it.
Yeah. It's up to the council to decide what they want to do. But the issue is, he was posed us a number of things that can or cannot be up there, and he's the gentleman that can answer them.
Yep. But I'll answer some of them.
And I don't think we have any problem with people putting a little toy truck on the stone. I didn't think so.
Point of order. When a motion is made to table and seconded, I believe that ends the discussion
yeah.
for tonight.
All right. You need to know.
I mean, Jane, again, Jane's not here to answer these questions, but, and I'm not an attorney, but.
I wish you was here tonight.
No more discussion. You're right. We need a vote.
All right, let's vote on it. All those in favor?
Wait, you have.
No, you have to roll call.
This is on tabling, right?
Yes.
Carolyn Toll?
Yes.
Scott Pope?
No.
Keith Raymond?
Yes.
Victor Bergeron?
No.
Alan Dearman?
Yes.
Bruce Temple?
Yes.
Nicholas Kloski?
Yes.
John Simons?
Yes. Mr. Mayor, could you clarify for the public what's going to transpire here with this motion?
What's going to happen? This is going to be postponed to the October 26th meeting when the attorney is here. There'll be another public hearing.
We have papers?
Yes, yes.
I'll make more next time.
They're online.
They're always online. On the city website.
Supposed to be, anyway.
Next.
So let's move on to the next topic, which is police Facebook progress report. Chief?
I'll be very brief. I don't have much to add. I know the framework is complete. I have not had an opportunity to sit with the captain and the officer who's assisting him with that project to make sure I fully understand exactly how it's going to operate before we launch.
Okay.
But we hope to have that done before the end of the year.
Okay. Thank you. Let's move on to new business. Motion to approve updated investment policy.
Once I find it, I'll make that motion. Said I've got to find. Oh, here it is.
Every year we bring forth the investment policy so that council has a chance to look at it, and we update it with any new revisions that have come out as part of state law. Excuse me. So there was some revisions made in there to update it according to RSA 34.5 and 35.9. And you'll see those in your revision, but there's nothing major in there. It changes the way that we invest our money.
You want to read the motion, please?
Yeah. Somebody begin at least the discussion part of it. I'll make a motion to adopt the city investment policy. The Claremont City Council, pursuant to RSA 47:6 and RSA 48:16, hereby readopts the City of Claremont investment policy as amended and authorizes the city manager or his designees to take such actions as may be necessary to implement said investment policy in accordance with state law and regulation.
I'll second.
I'm sorry, who got the second?
Councilor Raymond.
Thank you.
Any discussion on the motion? We have to have a roll call on this, right?
Mary, do you need a roll? Looks like voice vote.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Next one is a motion to reapprove identity theft prevention policy.
So the identity theft prevention program was initiated because of the identity theft and fraud that was going on several years ago. We started this. This is an annual program that's adopted according to the Fair and Accurate Credit Transactions Act that happened in 2003. We have a program in place that helps us and a procedure as to how we set up new accounts in the city. And this is, again, one thing that we do every year annually with the council. I thought we were going to do this in January, but I think we missed that deadline with the change of the fiscal year, so we're doing it now.
Yes.
I'll make a motion to approve the Identity Theft Prevention Program. the Claremont City Council pursuant to the, quote, Fair and Accurate Credit Transactions Act of 2003, end quote, Red Flag Clarification Act of 2010, end quote, and Federal Regulation Title 16, Part 681, hereby approves the City of Claremont Identity Theft Prevention Program and authorizes the city manager or his designees to take such action as may be necessary to implement said identity theft prevention program in accordance with applicable federal and state law and regulation.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Second by Councilor Raymond.
I'm trying to find it.
Anybody got any discussion on it? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
I got you.
Mary, are we supposed to have copies of the resolutions?
There should be.
What resolution?
One's coming up.
You should have them. Or you got scanned. They're in your packet that you received.
Yes.
Email number 4 or number 5?
I don't know.
9 or 12.
That's a, everything's buried here. I'm looking right now. It's crazy.
This is a process.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, where are we now? Hazard mitigation.
We did the motion there, identity theft.
Probably closer to 4.
Can we take a 5-minute recess and get those printed?
Yeah, let's take a 5-minute recess to get this straightened out. I can't find the resolution. Can you?
Not yet. No.
Yeah, we have resolutions on here. It's in your packet.
They're in the packet here, but they're not printed for us.
Yeah, 4 is not. I'm having problems with
it. It should be in email number 4.
Yeah. Email number 4?
Yes.
Yep. It's wonderful, but it won't come up.
Okay, they're there. We'll get used to this after a while.
All the other ones came up, but this one won't come up.
I'm getting his blank pages.
You're scrolling too fast.
Yeah.
I am?
Yeah.
It'll catch up.
The one that it's coming up.
Can you see it? Where's Chris when I need him?
I'm still in identity theft.
Ah.
Resolution. There we go.
The investment policy starts the.
Yep, there it is.
Well, it ain't coming up. It's going to take forever.
Move your cursor about halfway down the page and then you'll come.
What page number are you on?
The resolution's on page 20 of 39.
Okay.
Page 20.
Okay. You seeing this? They won't download.
They won't download.
And Bernie's not here to see us in the 21st century.
Well, we're going to have to get used to it, that's all.
There's smoke rolling out of the 21st century.
Yeah. It's very slow.
Oh.
Mine ain't coming.
Designation of Economic Revitalization Zone, Washington Street, ERZ. Be it resolved by the Claremont City Council after public hearing duly noticed that whereas in New Hampshire RSA chapters 162-N provides state business tax incentives to encourage job growth and expansion of private commercial or industrial base through the establishment of economic revitalization zones, ERZs, in certain areas of state, and whereas in the order of established an ERZ, the local governing body must petition the Commissioner of the Resources and Economic Development to designate an ERZ within the municipality, and certify that it meets the statutory requirements, and whereas this designation will enable new and existing businesses in an ERZ to establish eligibility for certain business tax credits. Now therefore be it resolved that the council hereby authorizes the city manager or his designees to undertake all actions as may be required to petition the New Hampshire Commissioner of Resources and Economic Development to designate the following listed area as delineated on the attached Exhibit A as an Economic Revitalization Zone ERZ, Washington Street ERZ.
I'll second.
Anybody got a presentation? What it's all about? Then we'll go to public hearing.
Sure. This is a state business tax credit program. I think the thing that's probably most important for people in the community to know is that it does not impact local taxes in any way. It does not change assessed value in any way. This is strictly for contiguous parcels that are underutilized. And you have a group there of about four or five properties with a lot of vacancy that's currently underutilized. So it is a request for the council to designate the zone. Once it's designated, it allows any business coming in, investing money and adding jobs, it allows them to apply to the state for tax credits against their business taxes.
Mm-hmm. So. Could you tell me what the business tax credits are? I mean, what percentage or?
You know, I'm not sure. We've talked about this before. The state does not have a whole lot of incentives for economic development. I mean, it's sort of a struggle. But this is one of the few they have, and they've put a finite dollar amount on it. So they funded it at $825,000. So people may not even get all that they apply for if they go over the cap. But I think it does no harm to have these, and it might benefit somebody coming in. So.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, Councilor.
So now I'm getting the idea that this is basically the Kmart Plaza, the Ford dealership, and that area.
Right. They're vacant. There's
just
a series.
Just so people know exactly what we're talking about. Mm-hmm. So it's Petron Road, the garage on the other side. Is a laundromat part of this?
I did add the laundromat because I think there's expansion
and
potential
Scoop
there.
Scoop City.
Yeah.
And you also have, what is the extent on the other side of the road? What is the other business on that? I know the Ford dealership and...
The two buildings are on two separate lots that were the Ford dealership. And then there's another one that used to be a used car dealership next to it, as well as a lot beyond that. So
yeah, that was the lot beyond Scoop City was a used car dealership.
Right.
Just want people to know where we're talking about. So
right.
Usually you have a slide up there, but now we don't.
And they have to be contiguous, so I can't like pull it down the street to a vacant building, you know, half mile down the road. This just happens to be a group with high vacancy at this time.
This is a group of buildings that the city and the owners have been trying hard now for the last 2 to 3 years to fill in. A lot of people have wondered what might go in the old Kmart building, what's going to go in the Claremont Ford, such on and so forth, just to clear that up as well.
Yeah.
So the city's trying to make a good effort on that, so.
Any other questions? Go ahead, Councilor.
I don't see in any of this information, Nancy. How many can a community have? Does the state limit?
There's no maximum number. There is one that I've had to pull off for this coming year because it's no longer underutilized and underperforming, and that was the Twistback Road ERZ.
Yep.
So you can have as many as you want, but once they're performing and you don't sort of have that contiguous group, it you have to de-designate.
Okay. How many currently do we have?
I think I listed them in the memo here. I think there are six. There are five because Twistback is coming off. So it was the former River Road TIF, the downtown TIF, Claremont Airport area, Sugar River, Sullivan Street Industrial Zone, and then Maple Avenue. We have a group of buildings there.
Any other questions?
No.
Being none, I'll open it up to the public if the public wants to speak on this issue. being done, I'll close public hearing, bring it back to the council. What the council like to do with this? You need a motion to either...
I thought we already had a motion and a second.
Any further discussion? Then we'll vote.
Need a roll call?
I think so.
Yep.
I think we need a roll call on this one, don't we?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Wait, roll call, right, please?
Carolyn Toll?
Yes.
Scott Pope?
Yes.
Keith Raymond?
Yes.
Victor Bergeron?
Yes.
Alan Dameron?
Yes.
Bruce Temple?
Yes.
Nicholas Kloski?
Yes.
John Simons?
Yes.
We'll move on to then to D, Resolution 2017-11, Adopting Hazard Mitigation Plan Update, public hearing.
Is the regular process of updating the city's hazardous mitigation plan. It was last adopted in 2011. It has to be reviewed and updated and readopted every 5 years. So here we are.
Go ahead.
I have a question. Can you explain what the plan is, please, for our audience?
Okay. In simple terms, it's a hazard risk analysis. It looks at the community and assigns risk levels to things that we face, you know, are likely to face, like flooding, blizzards, windstorms, and the like. And it's reviewed, it was reviewed over the past 4 months by city administration as directed and as guided by the subcontractors who were Upper Valley Lake Sanipee Regional Planning Commission. And once the risk assessments were adjusted and accepted, the plan was finalized. It was sent to FEMA. They reviewed it and approved it and sent it back to us for final approval by the council.
Thank you.
Good. Councilor Dimmer?
Yeah, the list of people involved with consideration is quite extensive. People from all office and so forth. This would also include areas within the city limits that might have a particularly high aggregation of hazardous waste or hazardous substances?
It looks at all hazards,
mm-hmm.
And it may be at the industrial level, mm-hmm. but it's a citywide examination of the risk that the community could face from hazardous materials to the other type of occurrences that I described earlier. But it's an all risk analysis, basically.
Okay. Thank you. It looked very good.
Any other questions? Okay. Fair.
I'll make the motion. No other questions?
Can I read the resolution?
I'll read the resolution. Excuse me, is what I meant to say. Resolution 2017-11, adopting the Claremont Hazard Mitigation Plan Update 2016. Be it resolved by the Claremont City Council after a public hearing duly noticed that whereas the City of Claremont has received assistance from the Upper Valley Lake Sunapee Regional Planning Commission through funding from New Hampshire Homeland Security and Emergency Management to prepare a hazard mitigation updated plan, and whereas several planning meetings to develop the hazard mitigation plan update were held in June and July 2016, and whereas the hazard mitigation plan update was presented to the City Council for review, discussion, and approval on October 12, 2016, and whereas the Claremont Hazard Mitigation Plan Update 2016 contains several potential future projects to mitigate hazard damage from various natural events in the City of Claremont, and now therefore be it resolved by the City of Claremont City Council, one, the plan is hereby adopted as an official plan of the City of Claremont. Two, the respective officials identified in the mitigation strategy of the plan are hereby directed to pursue implementation of the recommended actions assigned to them. Three, future revisions and plan maintenance required by 44 CFR 201.6 and FEMA are hereby adopted as a part of this resolution for a period of 5 years from the date of this resolution. Four, an annual report on the progress of the implementation elements of the plan shall be presented to the City Council by the Emergency Management Director. Be it further resolved that the City Manager or his designees are hereby authorized to undertake all actions and execute all documents necessary to implement this resolution.
I will second.
Second by Councilor Toll. Any discussions? I'll open it up to the public. Oh, you know, go ahead.
Can we get a copy of the plan?
You got it emailed to you.
Section 5.
Section 5.
It's all there.
Okay, thank you for that. The other one, have we ever, it says number 4 on here, have we ever had a report of the implementation to the council?
Annual report?
Yeah.
Specifically for that, I don't believe so.
Okay. I'm good.
Go ahead.
I believe this has been used in the past, and we've had some issues such as the floods in 2005 to help gain the FEMA funds
right
that were required and get our legislators and state senators off the dime, as I recall, using something like this.
So. Right, and it also, I believe, and this is a little outside of my specific area, but I believe this is also looked at when the city is applying for grants for highway improvements that may, you know, mitigate the problems before they occur.
Pre-mitigation.
Beg your pardon?
Pre-mitigation.
Right.
Any further questions? I'll open it up to the public. Anybody wish to speak on this? Seeing none, I will bring it back to the council. I just like to say one thing. The reason they do it every 5 years because everything changes in 5 years. Addresses change, new places come online, new people move in, and so it's an important document. So, anything else? Then I'll make a motion we vote then. Roll call vote, please.
Carolyn Toll?
Yes.
Scott Pope?
Yes.
Keith Raymond?
Yes.
Victor Bergeron?
Yes.
Alan Dameron?
Yes.
Bruce Temple?
Yes.
Nicholas Kolaski?
Yes.
John Simons?
Yes.
May I ask a question?
Yes, ma'am.
I just because of the way this was worded, it reminded me that is there a CERT group in this area that you know of? You know what that is?
I do, but I don't believe.
I thought they were active, but then.
Not locally,
I've seen
to
nothing
my knowledge.
Locally.
I think the closest one to us is across the river.
In Vermont?
Yeah.
Okay.
For the viewing public and for the few of us that have no idea what that is, what's a CERT?
I can't tell you. Sorry.
It's a secret. It's Community Emergency
Response Team.
Reaction Team.
Yeah, okay. I knew I wasn't the only one. I looked around this table, and I knew there were others. There.
We were going to ask. Anything else?
It is quite beneficial as a group.
Yep. Thank you, Chief.
Thank you.
Before I call for a break, I'd just like to have us think about something. And when we come back, the first thing on the agenda is going to take discussion time, water rates, I'm sure. And some of the ones below that are very simple. They're just resolutions that we can address. Who's going to do the resolution on the cemetery records? Okay, they're going to be here anyway, so when we come back, if we can move F and G up and get the police department out of here, then it'll just be DPW left. Is that okay?
No, because he made fun of me. No, I'm only kidding.
Sir, are you here for the water rates?
Yeah. Is that okay with the council?
Why don't we do police right now? Get them out of here.
All right, you want to do that?
Yes.
Let's come out and do the resolution, Chief, so you can go home. Then we'll take a break. Now if I can find that resolution, I'll be okay.
So we'll go with 2017-13, paragraph F. As you recall, last meeting I was here discussing these particular grants. This will provide $10,857.60 in overtime enforcement patrols, specifically targeted at driving under the influence. It's a critical component of our traffic enforcement program. The time frame for this commences this October through September of 2017.
Would somebody like to read the resolution?
I will read the resolution. 2017-13, New Hampshire Highway Safety Grant. Be it resolved by the Claremont City Council after a public hearing duly noticed that whereas the City of Claremont, New Hampshire has applied for and been awarded a New Hampshire Highway Safety Grant for DWI patrols in the amount of $10,857.60 for the period ending September 30th, 2017. And whereas the City would like to accept and expend the grant funds for that intended purpose. Now therefore be resolved that the City Council hereby authorizes the City Manager or his designees to undertake all actions and execute all documents as may be required to accept the DWI patrol grant in the amount of $10,857.60 from the New Hampshire Highway Safety Agency for the purpose of DWI patrols for the Claremont Police Department, and be it further resolved to raise and appropriate the sum of $10,857.60 for the Police Department from offsetting grant revenue to have no impact on the tax rate for the purpose of DWI patrols for the Claremont Police Department. And be it further resolved that the City Manager or his designees are hereby authorized to execute all documents and undertake all actions as may be required to implement this resolution.
I'll second.
And second by Councilor Simons. Any discussions with?
One question, and that's perhaps more for Mary than for perhaps for the Chief. In the sections where it started to be it further resolved and therefore be it resolved and so forth, nowhere in those sections do I see authorizations to expend the money. There's undertake all actions and execute all documents to accept. They'd like to accept and expend. Do we need the word expend anywhere in the actual resolution itself? That's what I was thinking, but didn't know. All right. I would like to make the following amendment then to the motion.
I need to correct you, but it says right there, whereas the city would like to accept and expend the grant funds for the intended purpose.
And I see that, but nowhere does it say resolved in granting the authority to expend in the following three paragraphs. I guess that's my nitpicking for the night, but I'm not sure that the third line really covers it. Oh. That's all.
Well, if you would like to.
So I'd like to make the following motion to amend the paragraph beginning with be it further resolved to raise and appropriate the sum of the next to the last paragraph to be now to read be it further resolved to raise, comma, appropriate, comma, and expend the sum of $10,857.60.
I'll second the amendment. Okay. The motion is amended.
No problem. The motion has been made and second to amend that. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. We can open the public hearing now. Anybody wish to discuss this? Being none, I'll close public hearing. And have a roll call
another
vote.
Public hearing.
Carolyn Toll?
Yes.
Scott Pope?
Yes.
Brannon?
Yes.
Victor Bergeron?
Yes.
Alan Dameron?
Yes.
Bruce Temple?
Yes.
Nicholas Kloski?
Yes.
John Simon?
Yes.
Thank you.
And with respect to resolution 2017-14, this is for the step enforcement program through the same New Hampshire Highway Safety Grant process. Total is for $11,066.40. STEP stands for Strategic Traffic Enforcement Program. and it includes the consolidation of three historical grants that we get. That's the New Hampshire Join the Click Seatbelt Enforcement Program, the statewide safe commute traffic enforcement program, as well as the general strategic traffic enforcement program for busy throughways in our community, generally focused on Washington Street, Main Street, and Charlestown Road. Those three grants have been consolidated together into the STEP program and would run during the same time frame of October of this year through September of 2017.
Somebody please read the resolution.
I'll read the resolution. Resolution, I lost it. Hold on one sec.
I'll add to it.
Resolution 2017-14, New Hampshire Highway Safety Grant. Be it resolved by the Claremont City Council after a public hearing duly noticed that whereas the City of Claremont, New Hampshire has applied for and been awarded a New Hampshire Highway Safety Selective Targeted Enforcement Program, STEP, grant in the amount of $11,066.40 for the period ending September 30th, 2017. And whereas the city would like to accept and expend the grant funds for their intended purpose. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the City Council hereby authorizes the city manager or his designees to undertake all actions and execute all documents as may be required to accept the STEP grant in the amount of $11,066.40 from the New Hampshire Highway Safety Agency for the Claremont Police Department. And be it further resolved to raise and appropriate the sum of $11,066.40 for the purpose, for the police department from offsetting grant revenue to have no impact on the tax rate for the purpose of implementing the STEP. And be it further resolved that the city manager or his designees are hereby authorized to execute all documents and undertake all actions as may be required to implement this resolution.
I'll second.
Second by Councilor Toll. Any discussion?
Yeah, I'd like to offer the same type of amendment for this one next to the last paragraph to amend that to read, be it further resolved to raise, comma, appropriate, comma, and expend the sum of $11,066.40.
Anybody second that?
I'll second that.
Okay. All those in favor of the amendment?
Aye.
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 Open up the public hearing. Anybody wish to speak on this? Being none, I'll bring it back to the council for the roll call vote. Any further discussion before I call for the vote? No? Can we have a vote, please? Got a roll call?
Hold on. Should go pretty fast.
The way he is.
Hey, Carolyn Toll.
Yes.
Scott Pope.
Yes.
Keith Raymond.
Yes.
Victor Bergeron.
Yes.
Alan Dameron.
Yes.
Bruce Temple.
Yes.
Nicholas Kloski.
Yes.
John Simon.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Chief.
That's for you, for me.
Let's take a 10-minute break. We'll come back at 8:25.
Computer.
I'll show you. Call this meeting back to order. Next topic on the agenda is ordinance 549, water and sewer rates, first reading. Who's going to speak first?
Hi there. Vic St. Pierre, Assistant Public Works Director, Water and Sewer. We presented six different options to you for your review. We have pro formas now for all six. At the last hearing, we were instructed to bring down the rates and show a capital plan. I do have to apologize. What I did send out on Thursday was two sewer capital plans instead of the one water and one sewer, which you guys must be totally confused, and I take responsibility for that. Hopefully you've got the right things in front of you now. In this water, in the three different, six different options that you have, we have one, the option one is just as, just to keep our operating budgets moving along, and I lost my page. Excuse me for a moment. There it is. Thank you. With me here is Paul Chiaffi, who has been a great help. He is our water and sewer billing bookkeeper, and he has done most of the work. So I have to really rely on his expertise a lot. Option number one is to increase the water rate 7.5% a year to cover the operating costs and existing debt, no capital projects. And you can see how it affects the rates. Option two is probably our minimum of what the water and sewer department can live with, is to increase the water rates 8.5% a year to cover the operating costs, existing debt, and required CIP. You can see the operates percent increase on the total water and sewer bill down below. Third option is to increase the water rates 14% and decrease the sewer rates 2.5%. Councilor Temple had spoken about keeping the sewer rates going up and adding some to this. We figured we should put this one in, but we're not recommending it. As you can see, it draws down our sewer cash balance from $4.5 million to $3.1 million if we do this. Now, option four, the freeze tier one usage, which is the 0 to 2,000 cubic feet, keep that at the same rate. So if people are conservative, the rate won't change at all. And then other water rate increases 17.5%, and sewer rates remain as it is in the new capital plan. This is one the staff is recommending to you. It makes the minimal amount of interruption. It shows that this draws the water cash balance is still going down from $2.5 million in 2016 to $2 million in 2021. So we're still not gaining, but we are doing all of our capital improvement plans. And six is what we had proposed the first time, increasing the water rates at 17.5%, and cover all the operating costs, existing debt, and original capital plan. I do have as you all know, we are in a drought right now around the state, and we've been getting warnings of that. But one chart that I do have to show is that this is in the high point in 1988, and we extended our trend line down to 2022. And that shows a 40% decrease in the amount of water that's being used as a city. So as we are trending down at 1.4% per year on water use, our costs are still going up. So with those two factors, you can see how if we had some growth or in our water system, then we wouldn't be asking for these for this increase. The other big part of this is option four that we are asking for. The water rates in 2017 and 2018 are still the lowest of the 10 rates we compared to in our first proposal back in July. So our water rates are still below Newport, Franklin, Keene, Hillsboro, Brattleboro, Lebanon, Durham, Hanover, and Somersworth. So it does raise above some of those in 2019, but we are we expect the others would raise also. And the last point is that we will be looking at these as part of this resolution or ordinance. We do have to bring this back to the council every year for reapproval.
Yes.
Hey, Mr. Vick, how many ratepayers, and I don't know if that's the correct term to use, but how many people, ratepayers, are in the 0 to 2,000 bracket?
All of them have that as a minimum.
Sure. Okay. Sorry about that.
And then if they use more than the 2,000 cubic feet.
Maybe the way I meant to say it, how many are solely within 0 to 2,000?
I think that's on that same page.
Is it? Okay.
Up in the corner. It gives you the 10th percentile uses 0 to 900
yep.
cubic
okay.
feet, and there's 492 of those, customers mm-hmm. of those. So the 50th percentile is right in that 2,000 range.
All right.
1,600.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions?
No. I see that chart now.
Questions of
well, first off, thank you for looking into that option four. I think it's important that when we look at young people moving into the community and our retirees that aren't using a lot of water, that although it probably isn't the best thing it for financially, it still does look at the consciousness of mm-hmm. conservation, which we're all supposed to be looking at anyway. So I appreciate that. That will help a lot of people. And one of those ideas suggested earlier. So thank you.
I just want to give the mayor, talked to me today about this, and her recommendation, if she was here, would be that all we do is fund the operations and their debt and no more for this year. Because what we're coming down the road after the first of the year. That was her recommendations. That's what she would like to see.
Yep.
Don't fund any more than pay what we need to pay to keep it running in their debt.
Yeah.
If they're going to do that, I'd go with the option two, because we are required by the state to do the spillway work and the lead removal.
Okay, what she put forth. That's all I'm saying.
Mayor, if I could, I just have a question. We had a higher rate proposal in the beginning. Now you lowered the rate. That's great news. Is there any news on any projects you cut out because of that?
Yes, under the capital plan, we did. Since the last meeting, we have not. We found out we did not get the Tiger Grant. So the Charlestown Road water wasn't in there, but the sewer is completely gone into a sixth year out of the capital plan. And if you look at the capital plan, we extended some of the projects out. We were able to use some of the forestry money against the spillways. And some of this year's, we hope to come back to you about swapping some of that forestry. Yeah, we got to get your approval for the expend the forestry money for the spillways. We'd still like to continue on with the meter program because it's such a good program. It's going to save us a lot of money in the long run. What other program do we have? Yeah, just those two.
Can you talk about the difference in bills of option four and option two?
Let's see. Option two, the increase is actually, if you look at option two versus option four, in 2017, option four is actually less. 18, option four is actually less. Option four moves forward in the third year, 2019, higher than option two. Actually, these are increases for each year. So you can see the total increase of 13.2% in option two for over the 5 years and 14.7% over the option four over the 5 years. Is that what you mean?
So in a semi-annual bill, the increase for option two is $44. In option four, it's $49. So for a $5 difference in 6 months, they're going to be able to continue with the meter reader program and do the other things in the CIP. Whereas with option two, they're only going to be able to do the two programs required by the state in our existing debt. So I think that's important to look at for the average user.
So, excuse me, mate, doesn't that generate any new money then, with what you're saying? If the bills don't go up much, you're not generating new money. Not much. Yeah, I mean, it can't be.
It's the median average user, which is half of the, it's in the 50th percentile. And we're drawing down cash balances as well with option four, weren't doing in option
two. But it's not generating a lot of new money then.
It's not generating a lot
of money. No, so that's, I mean, the options are keep it low and people don't get hurt, but pass up, I don't know whether it affects the lead replacement program or not. It does. Mm-hmm. So that's not great news either, because when Flint happens, you know, I mean, that's on my mind, and I just look at try to keep up with the water system. That's a council's call, but keep in mind that you're going to pass up some of these programs that you think are essential, and that's a tough call, that's all.
Any other questions?
Okay. Yep, I did, if I could. just looking at your CIP, the meter replacement program. So in 17 and 18, over the next 2 years, all of our meters will be up to snuff radio read program. Is that correct?
That's correct. We're doing, we felt that the meters should not be just out of the water funds. Okay. They should be out of a half out of the sewer, half out of the water, or a percentage. We've only got 2,700 sewer customers versus 3,600 in water. So percentage comes out of the sewer funds because that's how they're being billed from those meters.
That's so
that's an option four.
That's correct. So can I
go ahead?
I had two or three others. just for my point of view, the root control program, which is essential, and I understand that, but for $10,000 a year, probably ought to be over in your operating budget in the future. It's just my philosophy. I don't know how the council feels about when it's operations and when it's maintenance, but that was just a simple comment there. Yeah. On your lead service replacement going into 17 and 18, $250,000 each year, how many lead services do we have left? And it just get me close. Is it 500? Is it 100?
I'm going to answer that with what we found last month at up on Tuttle Ave. We were up there to replace two lead services. We found nine. Mm. So that we know of that has lead, there's about 100. But seven of those that we found were not known.
Okay, so 100, 125, whatever the number is, that's an approximate amount. Do you think that $500,000 for 100 services is $5,000 a piece?
No, I think we're figuring, we put in a bigger number. We had figured about $2,200 a piece per service. We had figured that when we start to look for the lead goosenecks, we don't have a good handle on how many we're going to find. We expect that Park Avenue, for instance, we found some up there that shouldn't have shown up on the record, so we might need to do all of those up Park Avenue. So we have applied for an SRF grant with, I think, 18 to 20% forgiveness. And so we hope to get that to start the lead program. I mean, to continue on with this program.
Just for point of information, I talked to Rick Skoranko, Council of Temple knows who I'm talking about. He's very favorable to this. I explained to him what we were trying to do here, and that would be around a 20% forgiveness between a lower rate and the terms of the agreement. And I think we don't count until we get it, but it looks favorable to us. After my conversation with Skoranko, so it looks decent that we'll get that. So it'll help.
What we'd also like to do with that, if I can follow up, is use our that capital, but reduce the operating budget. Keep that project in house, and so we would be reducing our operating budget and under the capital funds that come from the state.
That's an interesting concept. Did everybody digest that? Take money in from the state to reduce our operating budget and then pay that back over a 20-year period? Is that what I'm hearing?
Yes.
So
with a
take a loan to run your department?
No, because it's a capital expense to replace the lead, and they've already said that is. We would use the same crew that we have been using for the last 2 years to remove the lead.
Your crews?
Our crews.
DPW crews?
Yes.
I need to cogitate on that one. That's a little different.
I guess.
Borrowing money to run the department.
No, borrowing money to do the lead removals.
Which reduces your operating budget.
Correct.
So are you saying that next year when you come in here with your water and sewer budget, or your water budget next year, it'll be down by $250,000?
What I'm saying is that our, if we got this loan, it could be, or what we'll do is return everything that we can put into the capital budget, capital line item instead of the operating budget. So if we have a four-man crew out doing replacing lead lines, it's a capital expenditure. It isn't an operating expenditure. So we're not spending the operating budget, so we won't have as big an operating expense. Would I do it as a budget item?
Well, I know what the council's going to think. If we're going to borrow $250,000 and reduce budget, next year when you come in, we're going to say, well, look, we gave you $250,000 for 17, 18, another $500,000. Over the next 2 years, the operating budget ought to be down.
Well, if I could, I think you're onto something there, and that is that what you're saying, if I correct if I'm wrong, and that is that this doesn't solve the financial condition in that department. These rates don't do that. No.
Right.
No. But we came with a higher rate, and we liked it, so we went back and said, okay, but I want to be clear about that. We don't mislead anyone that that's going to be magic. I mean, you can't only do so much with the money you get. And what I'm trying to say is the option 2 and 4 don't solve that issue. We're kicking that can down the road a bit, and just what concerns me is the lead part. I don't know what that problem is. Nobody knows yet. When you went down there under that ground, you really see what's there. So we don't know whether it's 150 or 350.
That's right.
That issue really eats away at a major issue. And we want to make sure the council understands that and doesn't go ahead because we give you a lower rate. It makes it easier to vote for it. But it doesn't solve that issue, I don't think. So,
okay. If we have all of our lead out by next July, I'm going to want the same budget I have this year. We just won't expense that. Our budget will be way down for this year.
Okay. Can I? I just had two more questions, and then I'm pretty well.
Everybody okay with that?
Yep.
No.
I can. Well,
yeah.
Go ahead.
If not, I can come back.
Okay.
I can come back. I noticed in some paperwork here, it looks like we did adjust the public hydrant fees.
Mm-hmm. Yes, we did.
Yeah.
Okay. I thought I won.
Public and private.
Yep.
Yes. Okay. And then to bring closure, just for now, if I could, I noticed on your sewer plan in 18-19, there is a Scutney and Lafayette streets.
Correct.
If those streets are being taken apart and torn up and whatever to do new sewer services, will we get a new water line on those streets as well? And if we are thinking, well, why the streets dug up, we ought to do the water, but I don't see the water on the water CIP. And maybe it's not, maybe it's different.
That was our one more sewer separation on the Scutney Street that we were working on.
Okay. All right, and lastly, one thing that I don't think the council's had a chance to really talk about is what we expect for anticipated reserves. I know we're drawing down reserves by the notations here, but as the consultant said, you know, how much you keep in reserve or how much you want in your rainy day checkbook fund is really a policy decision, and I know we haven't had that conversation.
No.
So as long as everybody knows that whatever way we go here, the reserve funds that are set aside for rainy days will be drawn down significantly. Hopefully not to a critical point. I don't know what that critical point is. We really haven't talked about that. Anyway, that's it for right now.
Anyone else got any questions?
Yes,
Al. Yeah, there are just varying degrees of the reserve funds being drawn down. Each one of the options draws down the reserve funds by different amounts. I rather like option 4 personally. But coming to Councilor Temple's point, certainly you customarily would not ever borrow money to fund continuing operations. However, as I'm thinking about it, your budget was prepared not knowing what you were going to be finding for lead to be abated in pipes and so forth, correct?
We level funded.
Yeah, and then when you did your capital budget, you're essentially assuming when you look at that number, the same level of expense, let's say, that perhaps you had in your operating budget, not knowing what level of lead and so forth they're going to be finding, that same number would have been included in the capital budget as a potential expense. So the worst thing that can happen to you by not expending the amount of your operating budget, in theory, that goes back to boost up your reserve. Am I correct?
Right. This year's budget, I think the water department has $1.5 million close to it coming out of reserves.
Yeah.
It's a huge amount of money. Mm. And this is no different than the police get a grant,
mm-hmm.
and then they charge that person's time to that grant.
To the grant.
So in essence, instead of hiring a third party to come in, which is going to cost us more money to do it, if they can take their own people and charge it to that SRF to do this capital project, that's what they'll do. They yeah. won't have spent it in the operating budget. It'll drop into fund balance, back into retained earnings, or they'll do another project, like whether it's the meter program or something else to get a jump on it.
And when you come back in a year to bring your water rates back before us, as you've committed to do each year, I would suspect then that because the capital reserve was not drawn down as much as you might have thought when you prepared original estimates, that may indeed make a difference in the way that you look at water rates going forward.
Or we may have more users.
Yeah, well, and certainly we were going. Somebody was going to ask if you'd taken into account the North Country Smokehouse expansion, the New Hampshire industries, so on and so forth, if any estimate had been taken into account for those changes.
The trend line was down 7.15%. Mm-hmm. If it continues, and this only takes down a 2.5% decrease in, so that 5% is hopefully stop the trend from going down.
Okay. Thank you.
Well, let's continue that discussion a little more. If you had the $250,000 or the $500,000 that you're asking for through SRF and it gets approved to do your lead services, a normal process is you'd go out to bid and get a contractor to come in to do that work, and your crews would still be busy. You got plenty to do. There's a lot of maintenance. There's always, you know, plenty to do. So now what we're saying is, let's go out and borrow $500,000 through SRF. Let's go out and borrow $500,000 through SRF. Let our guys do the work, charge it off to the SRF loan or some special accounting number, and pay that back over a 20-year period.
Yes.
Pay for operations over a 20-year period.
If you want to look at it like that, yes, but this lead problem was between 1912 and 1934. Why should this year's budget reflect the problems that are related over for 100 years ago? So right now we are replacing lead services. I believe we're up around 140, 150 of them this year that we've replaced. And yes, we could put our crews someplace else, but when you're subcontracting something in the middle of the street that you can't define, okay, if you find it, you got to change it. If you don't find it, you just bury it back in. Flaggers, everything like that. I think we've got a better handle to keep it in-house than we do to sub it out. So it is a capital expense. SRF has already told us that. And they all have already told us that we can use our crews to do it.
Yeah, I understand that. I'm just really perplexed in my mind how maybe it'll be a short SRF loan, maybe it'll be 5-year, 10-year loan. I just can't imagine that we're gonna replace 100 or 150 services, reduce our operating budget, and then pass that out over the next defer that payment for the next 20 years. It's just a unique way of looking at it, I guess.
I would do it.
We can always discuss that further if you want with more information.
It would come to you anyway.
Okay.
No, what's coming, though, is the issues that we kick. Either you settle it now or settle it later. There's no way around that. Am I right about that? I'm right. So we're dead right about that. And no matter how you do the accounting, you're taking a shot, because it's less of an issue to vote a lower rate. So that's why we're out here, because we were concerned there'd be no rate. But I don't want to be in a position to say the lower rate's going to fix it. Lower rate may pass, and a higher rate might not. But I want to make sure the county understands that no matter how you do the accounting, you are not going to do the projects necessary that they should be done in the short run, period. So there's no way around that. And I don't want to not say it, because I'm uncomfortable saying it, but I'm going to say it because I don't want to live with that in the future saying, well, they didn't know that.
Yeah, I guess in my mind, I'm thinking that the loan is going to be taken. It's a done deal, providing we get approvals and so forth, whether it's outside crews, our own crews, or some mixture of the two. We are going to have an SRF loan over some period of time to do the work that's going to be required to get the lead out of our city pipes.
That's a fair statement, but we didn't have an SRF loan for the first 150. We've done those over the last 18 months. We've done 150, 200 services. There used to be about 350 of these problems.
That's very, very true. But the state came down on us since August and saying, let's do this. They have seen Claremont's, we keep very good records. We've always had very good records. So the state is using us probably as a guinea pig. Mm-hmm. So we've done some ways to keep our rates down as low as you can. You asked us to come in with some lower rates, and we've been very creative and brought you a really good proposal. Actually, six really good
proposals. I cited on the meeting with DES, and they made it quite plain what we got to do. And the lady promised that they're going to try to get the state legislature to put more money in the budget somewhere for this sole purpose of lead pipes. But she said, don't plan on it.
Yeah. Yeah. Well,
pretty much.
And
it's another case of where we're being told by the federal government and the state what we need to do, and we have to find the money to do it again.
Well, you can do it if you fully fund the... If you fully fund the rates,
right,
and you don't kick the can down and you don't borrow the money,
you know,
right,
and what were the rates going to go up if you fully funded?
Average would be $109 every 6 months for the average user.
Increase.
That's
in 5 years.
Ms. Walters, can you mind people at home? Right.
In the 5 years,
or somebody in didn't somebody
years.
Repeat that?
That over 5 years.
I think that's important. You're
that's
missing.
Over 5 years, though. It's not the first year.
Yeah, it'd be cumulative, yeah, at the fifth year.
Yeah, that's a real important issue.
If you look at the item number 6 was what we presented the first time.
Can I make a couple of us have alluded to the Charlestown issue, and I don't know that everybody's aware of what that Charlestown issue is, but it's come up in several different areas. One discussion was economic development. We can't keep improving the Charlestown Road without fixing the issues that are there, and that's water and sewer. So, go ahead.
Nothing to do with water on the Charlestown Road.
It's all sewer.
It's all sewer.
Okay, thank you. I don't know, you know. And I know we have a lot of other big issues coming, so.
Well, it boils down to the problem. We're forced to do this by law, and there's no much government help coming down the pipe.
And it's like everything else.
Our legislators don't seem to be pushing enough for it. And so what do we do? Like you said, we've got some stuff coming down.
It's only first reading.
Yeah. So we can put it through for first reading and discuss it further at public hearing. What do you want to do?
Oh, a public hearing is going to be important.
I'd put it through until public hearing. We can always, I suspect, say no to the loan.
But if you amend it, you go back to square one. So to explain it right, though, man.
That's okay.
So if you have to amend it, you go back to square one on the rate. You can't go ahead at a second hearing after you substantially change it from the first. So
I would prefer to do that because I still want more deeper information about this loan thing and how it works than I'm getting tonight. I want to understand it better. Whether it takes a sizable increase to cover that or whether we have to do something because the work has to be done. So
2 points. Have we gotten a letter from New Hampshire DES that says you will replace your lead services? Or is this just a strong suggestion coming out of Rick Skarenka? We'd like you to do it, and oh, by the way, we'll make some money available.
We have not gotten nothing in writing. We had Sarah Pillsbury, head of the Water Department, meet with the mayor, assistant mayor, her lead committee came here to meet with us and find out how fast we could change some things.
Yeah, okay.
How fast can they give us some money?
That's what we asked.
Well, they...
Not very.
I can just give you one. That day, she looks at... She somehow knew I was from St. Mary's, I guess. And she said, what's St. Mary's school doing with the lead in their pipes? And I looked at her and I said... And you talked to me about it, and she said, I strongly suggest you do it right off.
Before school.
That was her warning. I strongly suggest. Oh. Isn't that correct?
Yep.
And so we've got it done.
I'm not
and,
that. I don't think that.
But we paid for the the work, fortunately. Well,
Vic, I understand that, but I wonder, is she making that same statement to all water districts across the city?
We don't know.
I mean, I don't know. I don't know that lady. I know Rick Skarenka, and I don't happen to know her, but that just seems like a very strong statement to me that you better get it done. Well, hold on just a minute. Are you making that a mandate across the state?
She never did answer that.
And if so, maybe we ought to get a hold of Councillor Cloutier, our representative, who was part of the Public Works Committee down there, and ask him that question. What the heck's going on? And we're digressing here a little bit. I understand what we're trying to do. This creative stuff it caught me off guard a little bit.
That's good discussion.
And good discussion. I am concerned about drawing down reserves and however how you want to handle it, Mr. Mayor, is fine.
Then I think we approve first reading and put it to public hearing next.
Yes,
Councilor Clark.
Can I ask that we have like a PowerPoint for at least the second reading if this goes through tonight?
Sure.
Because I think this is hard for people. If somebody was here following along, this is very hard. And even here, we've got to keep turning this to...
Councilor Klosky makes a good point because they can see it and they're going to understand it better than...
You can see it at home. Right now at home, you don't have any idea what we're talking about.
The trouble with the PowerPoint, there were so many numbers that it didn't flow well. So, but I will try my best to get...
Well, I think it's... go ahead.
Go ahead. You had your hand up.
Me?
Yeah.
Oh, no, I just, too many people were talking.
Yeah,
I couldn't hear.
On approval for first reading, do we have to approve a particular option, or are we just approving this, the whole stuff that was sent to us?
In front of you, you have Ordinance 549, which is option 4.
Yeah, okay.
So when we come back to our next reading, the second reading, It'd be awfully nice to see what the impact is, not cumulatively, but per year on the average home. I mean, the...
It's here.
Yeah, so it's very clear to the public that, okay, in 17, I can expect $80 more per year, or whatever that number is.
$13. That's what she's saying. You're changing your number so you don't scare the public.
Oh, $13.
Is it possible to put up an actual mock-up bill that would come to your house and
sure.
So you're familiar looking at your water sewer bill so you can show that would be? Thank you.
Educate the breakdown of the invoice.
Yeah, because this will be on point. The website and everything else, and it'll be easy to figure out that. Okay.
And I think we're going to include any projects you can do under each scenario and projects you can't do.
Right.
So it's important for me to say that because I want that on there.
That would satisfy
me. Right,
right. It's very difficult to do that with six options. So if we can get it down to one option, then we can do a lot more.
Yeah. Well, we'll work on that, though. I'll help you with that.
I'm going to Mary, do they have to come back to us to increase the rates to 2017? Or 2018, whatever we're doing.
So the last ones you got were 6 years because that's what follows the CIP is it's typically a six-year plan. This is only 5 years. So this plan is going to go 5 years. Every year you have to review it. But if you do nothing, the next rate goes into effect. If we come back and we say we have more usage, we think it can be lowered, or we have a catastrophe, it needs to be increased, it would happen at that time. Mm-hmm. But if nothing happens, it goes on to the next year.
Can the council choose not to increase it at all?
You would have to make that vote at that time.
But it has to be reviewed.
Right, it has to be reviewed.
That's the point.
That's what
right.
I'm going to make sure that this
and
is...
And that is in the ordinance.
We don't know what's going to happen in the next 2 years. We should have the chance to have that final say. Okay, we have to have a motion.
You have to read the resolution.
Huh?
You have to read the resolution.
Okay.
That was at the top,
wasn't it? I'm gonna sneeze again. I think it's that air conditioner.
I'll read the ordinance.
Go ahead.
Okay. Ordinance 549, water rates, explanation of proposed action. The purpose of this proposal is to revise the municipal water rate schedule as a result of the 2016 updated water rate study recommendations presented to the City Council in July. Enactment of this ordinance will provide adequate funding to the Water Enterprise Fund for funding the costs of operations, maintenance, and capital improvements for the city's water system and treatment facilities, and to qualify for state revolving loan funds for future improvements to the city's water supply infrastructure.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Any other discussion?
Any
questions?
We have to have this option four. Is that falls under what the water rate study recommendations presented was their option four? Their recommendations. So
Okay, that's what we want to discuss.
I guess I'd recommend then adding to my motion adoption of recommendation number four. Not sure how to word it without reading through every single number.
That's in the resolution.
They're in the resolution.
Okay.
All right.
Any other questions?
As we move forward, you're asking to have a slideshow for one option. You couldn't do one for option four versus option one?
Option two.
whatever, the one you originally presented.
Well, we got to talk about that, how we can do that and bring it
so
forward.
So people know the comparison.
I'm not on the board for that.
Okay.
I'd like to see two comparisons, this option four versus the original one that
right,
we don't
and
kick the can down
said.
The road.
That's what I'm asking.
That's exactly
step
that's
up
what
and
he,
we,
yeah, that's
I support,
what
I support
said.
What you're saying.
Yep.
I would agree.
Any other questions?
I just have one. If we're doing a mock-up of a bill, and I know it's in these numbers here in the little chart in the corner, it shows you the rate where you fall as a user. Can we have a mock-up of one of each of those? So the senior citizen coming in with concern might not really be a concern to them because they don't fall in that category. I just.
Yes, we can do a mock-up for each category.
Thank you.
I think that would be important.
Yep. Any other questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? We have one more resolution. Resolution 2017-15, Moose Plate Grant for Cemetery Records, a public hearing.
We were very pleased to receive a letter from Moose Plate to deassify, clean, restore our last six cemetery books for $9,245 grant that we received.
Wow.
That would help them to never rip, rebuild the books and put them in a fireproof box like the others. It's just to restore all our old information in the cemeteries, and it's very pleased to receive this letter. So we're asking to, we've got a quote from a gentleman and for that amount, and he's going to hopefully get those done in the near future for us. With this grant and the last grant, we've probably got close to $20,000 into those restoring those books.
And I think if you go down to this office and see what she's done with them, it's really made a big difference in a lot of stuff, and the records are in well kept now, and and the maps are going to be taken care of so they ain't destroyed.
That's Norman Limoges spends a lot of time on the cemetery, and she did a nice job with this grant and spent a lot of time on it.
I think it's wonderful, and I thank all that were involved with this amount of money for a grant for that.
Any other questions? Open up the public hearing. Anybody who wishes to speak on this item?
Motion.
Oh, motion. I thought you read it.
Read the resolution.
I'll read it.
Oh.
Resolution 2017-15, Moose License Plate Conservation Grant. Mm-hmm. Be it resolved by the Claremont City Council after a public hearing duly noticed that whereas the city has applied for and been notified that it has been awarded a Moose License Plate Conservation Grant from the New Hampshire Department of Cultural Resources in the amount of $9,245 to fund additional preservation of the city's cemetery record books, bracket the project, and whereas the city would like to accept and expend said grant funds, now therefore be it resolved that the Claremont City Council hereby accepts the Moose License Plate Conservation Grant in the amount of $9,245 from the New Hampshire Department of Cultural Resources, and be it further resolved to raise and appropriate the sum of $9,245 to be taken from unanticipated revenue to have no impact on the tax rate for the purpose of funding the project. Be it further resolved that the city manager or his designees are hereby authorized to execute,
execute.
Yeah.
All documents.
We're going to do that.
Somebody has the rest of it. It disappeared on
all
me.
Documents and undertake all actions as may be required to implement this resolution. 2/3 vote required. Dated this 12th day of October 2016.
Whoop. I'll second it.
Oh, yeah. Carolyn second. Carolyn, got it.
Any further discussion? Yes, Councilor.
I'm sure the council will support this. I just wanted to say that this particular item is pretty dear to me. I was personal friends with the Commissioner of Cultural Resources, and this was our last conversation prior to his passing. So.
I'd like to make an amendment, if I might, and this will be from memory since it's not back in front of my screen. This would be in the next to the last paragraph to amend the paragraph to read to... To raise, comma, appropriate, comma, and to expend.
Okay, the sum.
You have a second?
Second it.
You just get that to Ray?
Yep.
Any other questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
It's a two-thirds vote.
Two-thirds vote. Oh, you do, okay.
On the amendment?
Oh, it's no. Just the amendment. No. I'm sorry.
Okay, you ready to vote on the motion?
The
roll call vote?
The voice vote.
It was.
Sorry.
Was I.
Thank you. Everybody said okay.
All yep.
Right. Now on the motion, or the resolution. Carolyn Toll.
Yes.
Scott Pope.
Yes.
Keith Raymond.
Yes.
Victor Bergeron.
Yes.
Alan Dameron.
Yes.
Bruce Temple.
Yes.
Nicholas Klosky.
Yes.
John Simons.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next agenda is committee reports. Anybody have any? Go ahead.
We're tentatively planning for the 19th, the zoning.
Which group, please?
I'm sorry. Zoning.
Zoning board?
Yep. Next week. Tentative date is Wednesday the 19th for a joint planning and zoning meeting at a site review on 154 North Street. Right? Yeah, North Street.
Okay. Two things. Historic Commission has seen a good uptick in a lot of applications for buildings to be renovated, redone, updated, and I just want people to know that there's a lot of stuff going on in town that we're seeing there. And
using the 79E?
Using a lot of different things. So not the 79E, but just general work around town. You've seen things like Real Steel.
Mm-hmm.
The chocolate factory everybody keeps talking about that's going to be in the building fondly known as the old Azerski's building. And even some work going on down at the old Hometown Deli building. Won't be a deli, but just so people know, there's been a lot of activity going on in the historic district, and important to mention, so people at least know there's some things going on. I've also been asked to mention to the council and to the public that the school strategic plan committee, there's a strategic plan being developed. There's about a dozen people who are meeting together to get some information and think about a five-year plan of excellence for the school. I've been representing the council and as a teacher in that. There's tentatively a forum planned from 6 to 7:30 on November 3rd to gather public input to see what has happened so far and see what people would like out of the schools. There's been a lot of very productive discussion on this, so put that on your calendar. Hoping to have that. Got to remember, I believe it was at the middle school, but you'll have an email sent to you.
Okay, I was just going to ask you about that.
A lot of things going on, as I said, in the historic district and also the schools looking to move ahead further.
Anybody else? Well, I have two. The mayor wants me to read you two letters that came in today from her. You all received a letter dated October 11th from her dealing with the steering committee. And today she got an update from Mr. Gould. She wants me to read it to you. After sending the last update, we processed one more resume bringing the total to 37 candidates. The resumes were received from all candidates in 18 states and one from Air Force Base in UK. There were six candidates each from Vermont and New Hampshire five from Virginia, four from Florida, three from Massachusetts, one each from Indiana, Georgia, New Jersey, Texas, West Virginia, Wisconsin, Washington, Connecticut, New York, or Oregon, Arizona, Illinois. All these candidates, of these candidates, two have a Juris Doctor and Master's degree, three hold a Juris Doctor and Bachelor's degree, 27 have Master's degrees, and five candidates have Bachelor's degrees. Their resumes were ranked by MRI team. There we go. And the essays, oh God almighty, you just put your hand over and it goes off. I'm going to bring my mouse next time. The resumes were, see, that stays there, I can't get rid of it.
And your mouse is right there.
Behind your computer.
Oh.
I'm sorry about that.
It works better when it's plugged in.
Plug that baby
although
right
it's
in.
Equally as sensitive, believe me.
Oh, yeah.
You can set that. But it's easier than a finger.
Yes.
The resumes were ranked by MRI, and the questions were distributed to the top tier of candidates. And one of the 16 candidates was withdrawn because he has accepted another job. The essay responses are now being reviewed by the MRI team. We are also doing some very preliminary background work in preparation for our phone interviews. These phone interviews should be completed by the end of the week. We expected that a few candidates may be eliminated due to issues we identified in our preliminary background work or the weakness identified in our phone interviews. As soon as these candidates have been screened out, we will send the submittals of each of the remaining candidates to the screening committee for review. The process remains on schedule. It is anticipated submittals will go out to the screening committee for review by the week of October 24th. Please don't hesitate to question me if you need anything. That's the first one. The second one she received today, she wants to read. This, she wants this to be made public. Just let me get to it. Dear Mayor Lovett, thank you for bringing the concerns of the members of the screening committee to the attention of the council. My intent is in asking for your assurance that the selection of the next city manager has not already been made in light of the conversation I've had with folks in town, was not intended to derail or delay the selection process. Rather, it is intended to underscore the need for an open, inclusive, and transparent process that will result in the city finding the most qualified candidate for the position of city manager. While it may seem interesting to explore the whodunit aspect of the source of my initial remarks, I have left it up to the council who spoke to express their position, and if when they feel it necessary, they can reveal it to us. I serve on the City Manager Search Committee in the last Claremont hire of City Manager. The search committee in 2001 is convened only after several very unpleasant and damaging starts and stops during the search process. For those who remember, the city had devolved into the terminal after the resignation of the sitting city manager. Claremont Fire Chief Peter Chase was appointed as interim manager until the new city manager. Mr. Baker says stayed a mere 18 days until his resignation. Fire Chief again served as interim for a time until another city manager, Mr. Hodgkins, was appointed. It was then that the City Council hired New Hampshire News Association to step in. Involved the public to create a profile of the ideal candidate and invited a large committee to sift through over 50 candidates. The committee forwarded the picks to the smaller screening committee, who then interviewed the candidates and made a full recommendation that fit the qualities, expertise, and proven track record to the city needed. The process resulted in genuine buy-in by the Claremont stakeholders because our reach and exclusion. Let me get back to where I was. Exclusion of taxpayers in the process. Thus, Mr. Senegate was hired and the city began to recover its pride and started to heal. As it stands right now, the taxpayers in the city are paying $15,000 to municipal resources incorporated to assist with defining the best possible candidates from across the country. Once the city manager is hired, it will be the taxpayers will be covering $135,000 each year for his or her salary. Therefore, it seems reasonable to ask the council for assurance that this process can be open, meaningful, and inclusive for the taxpayers and stakeholders in the community. Last thing the city needs is a repeat of painful process which endured in 2001. Thank you, Bethany, your co-chair of City Manager Search Committee. She wanted that read publicly.
I make that point.
Yes.
So what she's saying is that she made a statement saying that a counselor told her that the candidate had already been picked.
That's correct.
And now she's not, she made a public statement with that, and now she's not divulging, and she was requested to put it in writing, correct?
She did. She gave this letter, she sent it today, and she says it's up to the counselor to come forward, not her. That's what she's saying.
For the viewing public, there's none of us have heard any of the names of any of these applicants yet.
That it's correct. We have no idea who the candidates are.
And no, we won't know until it gets down to the final three.
It's just something we have to deal with, and the MRI is still on track to do their job.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to do it the way they want it, or else.
Mm-hmm.
And he'll handle, Mr. Gould will take care of that part of it.
Good.
And if we think it's necessary to find, do any research, or if a counselor said that, we have no proof. As far as I'm concerned, it's all hearsay. And we can go from there.
Okay.
Maybe I'm missing something, but looking at this process, applications go through this firm and then don't even come to the council before they're whittled down from that committee. So I'm failing to see where anything like that could occur.
Right.
Unless I'm missing something.
You're not.
And then we even went to the step of, at your suggestion, putting all 14 on there, not
right.
nine.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Not excluding anyone. So I'm very puzzled, but I guess there's my assurance that.
And speaking about the public, if you know the way they did it, you could call on the phone to Mr. Gould. You could email him, okay? You could write to him if you want. Or you could meet with him, his team, privately in the rooms that were set aside.
Right, he came.
I mean, there was plenty of time given for people to get involved. So I think we ought to put this to bed. And yes.
I'm satisfied with the process we've adopted. It's fair. It's open. I'm perfectly well satisfied with this.
And none of us are here to derail that process.
Oh, hell no.
And I would really like to emphasize the fact that we've put a time limit to the organization we hired, and I want that to come through exactly the way it was done for the time limit. I don't want anything to stop that.
The mayor wanted both of these read to the council tonight.
Good.
Make them public. So.
That's fine.
I understand.
I have nothing more. Anybody else? Mm-hmm. Everything is future topics. The only thing I have, when are we going to do the second reading on water rates?
Well, how's our agenda for the next meeting?
Don't put both of these on the same meeting.
Yes,
well, I know. But
you have to have a certain period of time between each.
They have
reading,
to have
so
10 days.
I couldn't
days,
tell you. I don't know.
First meeting in November, I guess.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, we didn't discuss that. We just did most of the second meeting. We didn't pick a date. That's why I'm curious. You want to do the first meeting in November?
Yes.
Okay. Can we do that, Mr. Sandegate?
Sure.
Okay.
City staff deserves an answer.
Yeah. It's on the 9th.
Mm-hmm. Start over here. You got anything for future agenda items?
No, sir.
Nick?
Yes. I personally think these computers are a nightmare, and if there is a cost to obtaining a paper copy of the council packet, even if it was here when I arrived, and I will pay that. I don't care, but I'm a paper person, and either I sit at home and print all of these emails, which I can't even explain to the public at home. There's about 40 documents here. But I like making notes on things and being able to quickly go back to something to cross-reference, and this doesn't happen. I'm watching everybody else struggle with this, and I've heard the comment that, you know, we'll adjust to it, but I'm requesting a paper copy. I don't need the police to deliver it to my house, but I will pay for that if I have to.
Answer to that, Scott and I have been working out, trying to get together so that we can help me become more proficient at this system. So I don't know if we can, you know, see if we can, and Victor, we've talked about getting together and just doing a...
I think there's a way that's very easy to do it through Google Drive, but I'd have to show it to you. Each person uses computers in their own way. I'm not having a hard time with this.
No, that's not my point. I'm a document learner, so...
And each person's different.
Yeah. I like sitting at home and reading the council packet, and I do miss that. And to be able to scroll through and make notes, and that's what I'm requesting. And if there's a cost to that, I will pay for it, but...
Okay, we can discuss. Anybody else?
Future agenda. Yeah, I think it was probably 6-8 weeks ago now, we talked about the merging of Moody Park and the city property.
We did.
We talked about that. And I'm not sure where that is, but one thing that I was hoping that maybe we could revisit was I'd asked about getting that merged and the property resurveyed, so that once and for all, it's at the county.
Yeah, I remember that.
And I know it's a little expensive, but I also know that we have revenue from this forestry fund, and part of the forestry management plan was remarking property bounds, which I think Vic St. Pierre indicated we've done thousands of feet of it. But I'd like to see or have the city do an RFP to survey the Moody city lot, prepare the maps and documents so that it's suitable for recording at the county.
I think when we discussed that, I think it's a good idea. It was the cost of a surveyor that it was put on the shelf, kind of.
Yeah, there is the cost of the survey, and I know the city attorney said, well, you know, you can put maps together and write the description and all that, but when you get out in the field, sometimes things are missing. Boundaries aren't always clear, and I just think it would be nice to have it surveyed and put to rest once and for all. And if we have to have an agenda item to raise and appropriate whatever it is, $8,000 or $10,000 out of the forestry management fund to pay for it, I'd like to see if we could proceed with that, because we're talking about a park that was donated in the early 1920s. And we've added to it some 80, 90 years later, and I'm hoping that it's a great place to be another 50 years from now. And it's a housekeeping thing. I know staff is busy, but...
Would you like that put on November? Well,
that would be...
November 2nd meeting?
Yeah, no, I think November all 9th. We'd need on the agenda
November
is...
November 9th meeting.
November 9th. We'd need 15 minutes or 10 minutes.
Can we discuss that November 9th, Mr. Sandegate?
Yeah.
I think it's a good approach because we've had a chance to meet with Mr. Sandegate, Mayor, and I on a place where somebody wants to swap land with us, but trouble is all the markers are gone, all the property, and so now we're looking at a surveyor either, because I have a problem just swapping land without it being surveyed. So I think that's a good idea. I know it's going to cost us money, but we got to do some of this stuff. Okay, anybody else?
No.
Nope. I just want to remind the council, we got a lot of big issues, and so I think we got to solve some things. I mean, just tonight we have the cemetery ordinance, we have water ordinance that we're going to have to solve. We got a city manager search to work on. We still owe the people on Ridge Avenue an answer. Mm-hmm. Park merge is something we started working on, and so I guess my request for the future agenda items and directives is let's start finishing some of this so we can start moving ahead on different things. So
good point.
But we can't do anything about Ridge Ave to the Conservation Committee comes back.
Yeah, I know.
And they're meeting next Thursday night.
They should give them an answer that says, yeah.
But this thing should very, this thing shouldn't take very long. Just find out how much it's going to, say, make a motion to go out and get what the cost was and go from there.
I agree. That's one of the things we talked about, and that's one of the things I don't know.
Carolyn?
My thing is that I have a real deep concern when the director of a department, fire department, comes to us and says that he is very concerned, that he's got several issues with properties that are not staying to code. So he needs some help with that. So I don't necessarily think it has to be November 2nd. I'd like to finish some of these things so that we can get them off our list. But I think it's very important, and I think he'd be involved, and we figure some solutions out. Because legally, we're going to have Jane here and the whole thing. But he's going to need some help, and we'll be into us if we have one of those homes with several units and we lose a wife to fire because this is transferred, you know,
but
months and months. So.
Just to talk about that is, I think you're going to remember either this year or last year, he came to us with that same issue and we didn't do anything about it.
Yes, we did. We gave him the $100.
Yeah, but we asked him if there's other ways we could help him. He said $100 would do, and now it isn't working.
Right, and that's my point. I mean, these landowners are just laughing at that. So that's what I mean. We need to find out what other cities are doing in order to get them to conform. And I think it's important. He's asking us for help if you read his report. So
I think what we're facing is the planning board had an issue the other night. What you're finding, what they're finding, they go out and do inspections. They've added another unit to their home. And so it's becoming an issue without getting building permits. And so this comes into effect what she's
just
saying.
So you know.
Okay, anybody else?
Go ahead.
I haven't seen the next agenda, but is my multifamily housing assistance inspection item on that yet?
There is a discussion.
Yes.
That discussion.
Yes. Okay. Some of this will be addressed during that.
It's the welfare program you're talking about.
Yes.
It's on there.
Okay.
Nothing else? We have no lawyer, so we ain't going to have a consultation with legal.
I'll second the motion.
By Alan Derman to adjourn, and second by Councilor Temple. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
That was quick.
Thank you for helping me.
Sorry, I'll show you. Second.
Kidding. I'm getting very familiar with this now.